started. This is the April 16th, 2018, 7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and we are all present. So, Commissioner Sutton, if you would please lead us in the invocation.
Before I say anything, I would like to say we only have a chance to do this if we volunteer for it once every 5 months. And over the years, I've had my invocation as a prayer, but recently I have been feeling like I'm being led to say other things, as I did last week. And I would like to, instead of offer a prayer, just relay a couple of things to you that mean a lot to me and have been a big part of my life over the last several years. Years ago, I attended a revival, not a revival, but a crusade somewhere, and the sermon was based on Jeremiah chapter 12, verse 5. And just to read that verse to you, I would like to say it's probably been the most uplifting words I've ever read in the Bible or been able to speak about when I'm not looking at it. But it says, quote, if King James Version, if thou hast run with the footmen and they have wearied thee, then how canst thou contend with horses? And if in the land of peace wherein thou trustest they wearied thee, then how wilt thou do in the swelling of Jordan? Jeremiah was complaining to God, why do good things happen to bad people? And bad things happen to good people. And God's reply back was just that. If you have run with the footmen and they have wearied thee, how will you contend with horses? In other words, the big things. And that means more to me than anything I've ever read or heard. And I hope it meant something to y'all. If we could do the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I sure got away from it. I didn't have time for this.
All right, next on our agenda are public speakers. Ladies and gentlemen, we have two opportunities for the public to speak tonight. The first is at this time for public speakers, and then the second is at the public hearing concerning the bond referendum, the bond for ABSS and the bond for ACC. So if someone has the intent to speak about the bond, the proper time would be later in our meeting and not at this time. However, we do have an opportunity for public speakers, and we have a few who signed up, so and some of them did not provide their topic, so we're not sure which is the appropriate time for them. Before we do that, let me go over or review the rules for public speaking at the commissioner meeting. We do have a public comment policy, which is adopted in September 2014, which is available for review on our website. Some of it is directly related to the public speaker section of the agenda, not necessarily to the bond proceeding. So the gist of it is that speakers address the board from the lectern at the front of the room and begin their remarks by stating their name and address. Public comment is not intended to require the Board of Commissioners to answer any impromptu questions. Speakers shall address all comments to the commissioners as a whole and not to individual commissioners. Discussions between speakers and members of the audience shall not be allowed. Speakers shall be courteous in their language and presentation. Speakers who have prepared written remarks or supporting documents are encouraged to leave a copy of such remarks and documents with the county clerk. Then the speakers shall not discuss any of the following matters which concern the candidacy of any person seeking public office. Matters which are the subject of public hearings, and that's because it comes later in the meeting. Matters which are closed session matters, including but not limited to matters within the attorney-client privilege, anticipated or pending litigation, and some other things. Speakers shall not engage in personal attacks that by irrelevance, duration, or tone may threaten or perceive to threaten the orderly and fair progress of the discussion. Then in decorum of the audience, this is in some rules that the commissioners adopted last year. They're mostly taken from statute and from the practice of the board before that time. In order to efficiently transact public business, it's necessary that members of the audience demonstrate an appropriate decorum and respect for the board and speakers. To this end, audience members shall conduct themselves as follows. Audience members shall refrain from making unsolicited comments during the meeting. During speakers from the floor or debate by the board, audience members shall refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceeding. This conduct may include, but is not limited to, cheers, hissing, booing, clapping, cursing, or any other conduct which disturbs the proceedings. Audience members shall refrain from displaying signage that obstructs the view of others in attendance or presents a safety hazard. An audience member shall silence all cell phones and other electronic devices while attending the meeting. So if you would kindly take the opportunity to check your cell phone or device and be sure that it isn't silent, that would be much appreciated. So for the people we have who are assigned to for the public comments, and I hope I've been clear, there's the public comment part of the meeting where you can talk about anything unless it's limited by the rules. And then there's the public hearing later that's about the Vaughn presentations. So I have a few people here that I'm not sure where they fall. And I'll call your name, and if you would mind, just let me know where you fall with that. So Lisa Marinis, M-A-R-I-N-I-S, I have that person marked down as commenting on the strategic plan. Is Ms. Marinis here? And can she help me out with that? Okay, we'll come back to her. Then Yoon Boylston, B-O-Y-L-S-T-O-N. The Vaughn, okay, great. I will put you on that. Tara Raggett, is Ms. Bond? Okay. Taylor Coffey? Okay. Erica Johnson? And Valerie Sellers? Bond. Okay. Well, that clears that up. So, it is confusing, I'm sure, when there's different things to sign up for. So now it is time for the public speakers. The only public speaker that's not talking about the bond is Lisa Marinis. If Ms. Marinis is here, this is the appropriate time for her to come forward. And I don't see her, so I guess we have no public speakers tonight for that section part of the agenda. Do we have any commissioner responses? Hearing none, approval of the agenda. If everyone has had an opportunity to review the agenda, are there any clarifications or alterations to the agenda?
I make a motion that we approve.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second for approval of the agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, consent agenda. We have a few items on the consent agenda. Is there any discussion or need to pull something from the consent agenda?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Second that.
Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor of approval of the consent agenda, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, so public hearing. We are going to need a motion and a second and a vote to go into the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor of going into the public hearing regarding our bond referendum?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, regarding the public hearing on the bond referendum, I am fortunate that I was able to attend the ABSS redistricting public comment opportunities that were chaired by Mr. Van Pelt. So I had the opportunity to observe him and how he handled the number of speakers that came forward. So what we're going to do is I'm going to call to begin with two names. I would like for the first person to come to this microphone and the second to come to that. And then when the first person is finished speaking, I will call the third person. And if they would go ahead and go to that microphone while the second person speaks, then we can keep moving along and not have to wait for people to come forward. And hopefully we'll be able to proceed more expeditiously and be able to get as many people to speak as possible without undue delay. So, and also the final thing is if you could please spell your name. When we have a public hearing like this, we're actually creating a record. It's a legal proceeding. And if you spell your name, it would be very useful for the people who are making the minutes. Finally, please do not applaud after a speaker is finished. When the first speaker is finished, we're going to go straight to the next one, and that person's time is going to start. So if you're applauding and that person has to wait for applause, then that means that they don't get as much time to speak. And then we also, it's 5 minutes. So each speaker will get 5 minutes to speak. So our first one is Dr. Bill Harrison. If you would come forward. And the second speaker is Mac Williams. Mac, if you would please make your way to the second microphone.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, I appreciate the opportunity to come and stand before you and talk about the culmination of about 3.5 years of work. You have been, many of you have been intimately involved in that work. We presented our proposal to you just recently, and as I said when I presented that proposal, this is about bricks and mortar, certainly, but it's about much, much more than bricks and mortar. It's about us making a statement that we're ready and willing to invest in our students. $150 million is a lot of money. We recognize that. We worked very hard to get this figure down to $150 million. As I shared with you when we were last together, we brought in an architect, gave them a $150 million target. That was the result of conversations I had with then Vice Chair Boswell and then at that time Chairman Dan Engel and at that time County Manager Craig Honeycutt. They did some work for us for about 9 or 10 months, and they came back and the package was somewhere in the $220 million area. We kind of whittled that down a little bit, got it to about $170 million, and asked them to go back again, and we have it down to $150 million. Again, an awful lot of money, but just a start. I really want to express my appreciation to Brian Haygood and the county staff for the work that they've done with the Davenport Group to find a way that we can truly make this something that is fiscally manageable, that it will have an impact on the tax rate, but nothing of the extent that we were hearing about early on. So again, Mr. Haygood and Susan and his entire team and all who worked on that, my deepest appreciation to you. We have our advanced ed accreditation group in town this week. They visit every 5 years. And we spent most of the time 2 hours speaking to them this morning. And if you can imagine the pain of having to listen to me for 2 hours. But I shared with them the vision and the great job this community did coming together and creating a vision for public education that any community that valued its children would embrace. This community has embraced it. You have provided unprecedented support to us the last 3 years, and we appreciate that. We feel that we're really at a point that we're moving forward. I think this is a true tipping point in public education in Alamance Burlington school system, and this is about much more than bricks and mortar. It's about specialized program. It is about capacity. It is about safety. It's about kids, and it's about our future. And again, two of you have served as liaisons to the board, so you've seen this through the unveiling. As Chairperson Gailey indicated, many of you have attended our public hearings, so you know the work and the thought that went into the student assignment plan. I think you know and you understand the work and the thought that went into putting together this bond package. It's not us trying to be elaborate, it's us trying to catch up. School systems all across this country had fiscal problems since 2009 when the economy crashed. We're in a position now that we can come back from that and that we can provide this opportunity for our kids and really move forward. I can stand and talk for a long, long time about this and try to convince you to say yay to $150 million. All I'm asking you to do is let the voters decide whether or not we invest $150 million. We had people out front holding signs, let Graham decide, let Mebane decide, let Green Level decide, let Burlington decide, let Elon decide, let every community in this county decide. So I'm not asking you tonight to raise taxes. I'm not asking you to do anything special for the school system other than let the people of this great county decide whether or not they want to invest in their children. Thank you for the opportunity.
Please help applaud. Zach Williams, go ahead. Oh, excuse me, Mac. The next speaker would be Ed Hooks. Councilman Hooks, if you would come forward. And please don't forget to spell your name.
Thank you, members of the board. My name is Mac Williams. I'm speaking to you tonight as the president of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce and as the economic developer for the county. Dr. Boylston, whom was mentioned a moment ago, is going to be providing the official chamber statement. So I'm speaking to you on the perspective of the economic development professional that tries to sell Alamance County every day to businesses and industries that are looking for a location. And Alamance County is a growing county in a growing state. We are our location on two interstates, between two commercial airports, between two metro areas with proximity to both of those is an obvious driving factor. Business and industry are looking for places where there are people. They need labor. People where the quality of life is in a growing quality of life. Schools, housing, medical care, recreation, shopping, all of those amenities are what my clients and my prospects are looking for. And I take these folks on tours of communities and I drive them around, and this is what they're looking for, because they're looking for a place that will reflect the kind of place that they are wanting to be. I'm reminded of a story many years ago. I was an economic developer in another community. I had a gentleman, we're riding around, I'm showing him the schools, the hospital, neighborhoods, shopping centers, and we're talking about the kind of community I'm presenting to him. And he said, I've got a question. He said, how many bond issues has your community passed, say, in the last 10 years? I didn't have the answer. I said, but I'll get it to you. I said, I'm curious why you ask. He said, well, it's just kind of a personal thing for me. He said, my company's getting ready to invest $30 million. Why would I invest that $30 million in a community that doesn't invest in themselves? I'm trying to figure out if that community invests in themselves. And so this is a great opportunity to demonstrate that we are, it's a positive thing going on here. We've got a low unemployment rate, housing prices are rising, wages are rising, opportunities are abounding. So we've got a great story to tell. We're doing this because we're growing and we're trying to keep up with growth. And so this is an excellent opportunity to invest fully, as the school system and the community college have requested, in the infrastructure that is so critical to the growth of our product here in Alamance County. We've experienced a 5.2% change in population since 2010 to 2016, this from the North Carolina Office of State Budget and Management. We're 18th in the numeric change of people. We're 12th in the percentage change of in the state with among the counties with higher populations. Swepsonville and Mebane were numbers 36 and number 63 in growing municipalities, this out of 563 municipalities in North Carolina in that time frame. So we're growing, and we've got to be able to accommodate that growth. Along the same lines, while we rank 17th in population in North Carolina, we rank 5th in total retail sales. This speaks to the sales tax option. We've got a lot of people coming in here who are not residents who are leaving behind sales taxes due to their purchases. Why should the burden fall all on us as taxpayers when we can bring in other people's money to help us pay for this? So the quarter cent sales tax, I know, was also out there, and I would encourage good thought about that. So we've got a great story to tell. We've got reasons to tell people to be confident that if they invest in Alamance County, they're making a good investment. The board As you'll hear from Dr. Boylston shortly, the board at the chamber is in favor of both requests at the full amounts, as well as including the properties, the quarter cent sales tax being on the ballot. So thank you for your time, and thank you for this opportunity for public presentations.
Thank you. Sandy Ellington Graves, could please come forward. And go ahead, Mr. Hooks.
Thank you. I'm Ed Hooks, Mebane City Council and Mebane citizen. I appreciate this opportunity tonight to talk to y'all. This is a very difficult situation, but we appreciate your listening to us. If I may, I got some notes. Much of Mebane's growth is due to our economic development partnership with our county commissioners. Since 2010, incentive contracts have been signed with 17 companies generating 1,800 jobs and new investment in tax base of $475 million. Population since 2010 has grown because of these jobs, as well as the surrounding growth in the Triangle and the Triad. 2010, the population in Mebane was 11.4. The rate we're growing by 2020, the population will be over 17,000, an increase of 5,700 homes. That's 51% over 10 years and works out to be about 48 new people every month. During the past 20 years, Mebane has grown at a rate of 4.7% compared to Alamance County as a whole of 1.8. Tax base growth in Mebane, and therefore the county, has been booming. Since the last reevaluation in 2010, the tax base in Mebane has increased $662 million. In 2010, it was $1.4 billion, and today it's $2.1 billion. Much of this is, again, due to economic development partnership with our county commissioners and our county. Currently, Eastern High School has 245 students over capacity. 25%. South Mebane is 43%, or excuse me, 7%, and other Eastern District schools are 16. Mebane and the Eastern District is under stress. According to county planning projections, Eastern High School is projected 46% over capacity. Garrett at 16 and South Mebane at 18. Since 2015, we've approved single family projects to the tune of 1,700 units. Of these, roughly 492 have been permitted for construction. 1,206 dwelling units have yet to be permitted for construction. This does not include older approved developments, much like Mill Creek. As such, using the CLP numbers as a base, Mebane now has a total of 8,574 approved housing units, 5,400, 63%, are single family, and 3,035% are multifamily. When we account for the potential stock to be constructed, 67% is single and 33% is multifamily. We support the full board, bond referendum, please. $150 million and $39 billion. Why? Overcrowded schools, citizens concerned about inadequate school capacities. Growth is coming and we cannot stop it. Both North Carolina is growing in general, as all the urban areas in North Carolina are. Low interest rates, no significant school construction, especially in the high school level, in 60 years. Economic development, as Mac alluded, Alamance County needs to improve the education asset in order to attract higher paying jobs and improve our household income in comparison to our neighbors along the interstate corridor. Look at it as an investment and an income-producing asset. It's time. And also prepare our children for the new reality of technology. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Hooks. Allison Gant, if you would come forward. And go ahead when you're ready, Ms.
Sandy Ellington Graves, SandyEllingtonGraves, 2746 Jacobs Trail, Burlington. Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I come to you as an engaged citizen, as a member of the business community, and most importantly, as a parent. As an engaged citizen, I believe that we are all stakeholders. We all benefit as our county grows and prospers. Our communities must embrace this growth and many opportunities it brings to Alamance County. But a school system that does not offer adequate facilities and learning opportunities is a barrier to our growth and threatens our vibrant quality of life. As a member of the business community, I have been a local real estate broker for almost 16 years. When buyers are purchasing a home, it is no longer simply location, location, location. I see firsthand the impact a school system, the quality of education, and the performance of a school has on where a buyer chooses to buy a home. Simply put, the quality of our schools has a significant impact on the property values in Alamance County. It has a direct impact on our county's property tax revenues. Good schools mean higher property values, and that means a growing property tax revenue. As a mother of three, I have been actively engaged in ABSS since 1999. Almost two decades later, we still have inadequate facilities, we still have serious overcrowding, we still have achievement gaps, and we still have fabulous teachers that we cannot competitively compensate. As stakeholders, we must invest in our schools. We cannot create a world-class school system without state-of-the-art facilities, attracting and retaining excellent teachers, and offering a curriculum that is designed to advance science and technology. Sadly, I have a daughter that's graduating at the top of her class in elementary education at NC State. She will not apply, will not even consider applying at ABSS to teach in our county, because our past investment in our schools pales to the counties around us and the rest of North Carolina. Her top choice is Orange County. How many other good teachers are we losing because we send the message that education is not a priority in Alamance County? I truly believe that the greatest opportunities are often found in the greatest challenges. I challenge each of you to consider the opportunities that this school bond referendum, the opportunities for our engaged citizens, for our residents, the opportunities for our business community, and the opportunities for our children. I urge you to support the $150 million bond for ABSS. The return on this investment is priceless, absolutely priceless. Thank you.
All right, thank you. The next speaker is Tripp Riley.
Yes.
Did you hear Tripp Riley? If he would come forward, please.
Thank you, Commissioner Gailey and commissioners. My name is Allison Gant, A-L-L-I-S-O-N-G-A-N-T, 2306 Hickory Avenue, Burlington, North Carolina, 27215. I want to thank you for the opportunity to share just some thoughts from the perspective of Alamance Burlington Board of Education. I know that you're hearing from a lot of speakers tonight, and we're here because this is important to us and to our county. As elected officials, you have a great responsibility, and I can certainly appreciate that. But this issue, the Alamance Burlington Board of Education's requested bond, is one that our citizens should decide, as demonstrated by the number of people here tonight. As school board chair, I know many of those that are here tonight. Every day, they are in our classrooms, participating with our PTOs and PTAs. They are our neighbors, they are our business leaders and community, and they are all working to make sure our students have an opportunity for greatness, an opportunity for a future without limits. That's why we're here tonight. The decision that you will make tonight will say a lot about our community, our goals, our priorities, and our future. Over the last few months, the school board and the administration of the district have worked closely with your county manager in developing this bond package. ABSS has done its due diligence. Does it include everything we need? Of course not. But we believe it is a solid package that is realistic for both our community and our schools. You have engaged in many of these conversations. You've asked questions. And and the relationship between the school board and you, our county commissioners, has been and is open, accommodating, and respectful. And I am grateful. The bond package is for $150 million to repair our aging schools, add badly needed classroom capacity, including an additional school building, and to get the environment that our students learn in and that our teachers work in to an acceptable level. There is no frill in this budget. The number at which we arrived is based on real needs after almost a year's worth of research, and before that, many, many discussions. Certainly, you have the power to cut that number down, but I would ask, what is your rationale? Is it too much money, some might say? But historically, that has what has been the reason why we have not fully invested in our schools. And it's the reason why we're here tonight to ask you to support the $150 million bond. I have faith in our community. I truly believe that we will all do the right thing for all of our futures. Let's not shortchange our students, our teachers, or our community tonight. Put the full request upon the ballot and let our community decide. Our residents can make the decision if they're willing to invest in our public schools, our children, because they are worth the investment. Thank you.
Thank you. Griffin McClure, please. Go ahead when you're ready. Actually, hang on just a minute. Griffin McClure. Thank you.
Good evening, County Commissioners. My name is Tripp Riley, and I'm the current student body president at Eastern Alamance High School, and I'm just here to talk to you about a few reasons why our school needs the bond to be approved. My first reason is this. Eastern Alamance has 1,300 students. We have three guidance counselors to oversee all of these students. ASCA, the Association of School Counselors, says that a school counselor should not have over a maximum of 250 students. By this math, each of our counselors have 434 students to oversee. We have 180 days in the school year. I would think that it is physically impossible for someone to see every student, including seniors who are applying for college, taking ACTs and SATs, and needing assistance on their applications. I find this very hard for counselors to do, and I'm not sure how they do it. My first semester I took AP Psychology, and we did not have enough textbooks to go around for our class. We had 35 students in a college-level class, and we did not have enough textbooks to go around. We had to go to Western Alamance High School to see the need for more textbooks. I find it very hard to believe that this bond cannot be approved because me as a student trying to further my education by taking college-level courses, and you're telling me that there is not enough money for me to actually have a textbook in the class, I find that a little bit ridiculous. My next point is my cafeteria. We have approximately 25 minutes for each lunch period, and due to overcrowding, it takes about 15 minutes for us to get through our cafeteria line, leaving us only 10 minutes to actually eat our food and take a break from our 7-hour day. And also, if you're lucky enough to get through that line, there might not be a place to sit. Ladies and gentlemen, you do not have a place to sit in your cafeteria if you go through the line and actually eat food. We have students that choose not to eat lunch at our school so they can actually have a place to sit down and take a break during our 7-hour day. My next point would be our janitorial staff. We have three janitors to oversee 1,300 students every day. My father runs his own cleaning business, and he says this would probably be physically impossible for his cleaners to do, and they're professional cleaners. We have our bathrooms that have not been changed since 1962. We have the original structure from the early 60s. Most of our stalls don't even have locks on them, and some of them do not even have doors on them. We have students that sign out of school just so they can use the bathroom, and that could possibly be a 20-minute drive, and that's depriving us of our learning. Thank you, and that's it.
Thank you, Mr. Riley. The next person is Ian Baltunas. Baltunas, if you would come forward. Did you hear me, Ian? Ian Baltunas. Thank you. Go ahead.
Griffin McClure, G-R-I-F-F-I-N, MCC, L-U-R-E, City of Graham resident, Graham City Council. I'll try to be quick. I'm here tonight alongside other municipal leaders to beg you to let this county decide its own fate. I hear every day that public education is the biggest concern of our citizens in Graham. Mebane hears it, Burlington hears it, Elon hears it, we all hear it. But it's also documented. It's in our strategic plans, it's in our surveys, and God knows it's in our inboxes. So why is this issue we all hear about every day not being addressed? Why is there no investment in that future? We can't touch it at the municipal level, and we see counties around this country working 5 years ahead to solve the problems we face and then realize we are 15 years behind. We can argue all day that discipline, not dollars, is the issue. But even if it is, and it's not, you are our county's leaders responsible for fixing these issues. $150 million, not $100 million, for ABSS begins to do some of this work. I don't see pragmatism in your working to solve this issue. I do see some pessimism, and I even see some disdain for the public sector, and I see leaders elected that are okay with just keeping the lights on at our public schools. I realize all of you may not be hearing me tonight, but I am talking to those of you in front of me that internalized the oaths you took. I'm talking to those of you who are bothered at night by the 50 mobile classrooms we have that tell our kids that their education is secondary to other spending. I'm talking to those of you who realize 3.5 million square feet takes money to be maintained. And I'm talking to those that believe in the democratic principle of letting the voters decide. Let us decide if what the publicly elected school board says is the right number, is, in fact, the right number. Please, let us decide. If you lower the $150 million number tonight, my hunch is that the new school is the first to go. And with that, redistricting is negated. I was part of approving the chamber's vision plan 5 years ago, and I support the school board's 2 years of work on redistricting. We won't get this chance again anytime soon. Each of you knows that. Please, let us decide. But if you still think discipline is the issue, redistricting and pride in facilities addresses that. If you are still skeptical that the dollars aren't being spent wisely, let the public decide where their money is spent. If you still think $150 million is too much, please let Graham decide. That's all I ask for my constituents, that's all I ask for my family, and that's all I ask for all of us here. Let us decide. Thank you for your time. I thank each one of you for your service. We know the work is hard. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ian Baltudis, and it's my honor to serve as the mayor of Burlington. Tonight I stand before you on behalf of our council to let you know that every year we make tens of millions of dollars in investments throughout our community, in roads, in water, in sewer, in sidewalks, in trails, in recreation, in transportation, in economic development, in small business support. The list goes on and on and on. But there's one item, one drastic item that is the number one hindrance to our economic development that we cannot invest in, and that is education. And I'm here on behalf of the council, on behalf of myself, and on behalf of the voters of Burlington to ask you to put the full $150 million ABSS bond on the ballot. And as Griffin said, let our voters decide. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Baltudis.
Martha Crowell, K-R-A-L-L, 3844 Heritage Drive, Apartment 302, Burlington. Good evening. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. I'm Martha Crowell, a proud senior citizen of Alamance County and a proud citizen of the United States. I moved to North Carolina 11 years ago from New Jersey. I would like to start by making a reference to what Commissioner Sutton said at your April 2nd meeting invocation. You said, what is my purpose? Well, I want to expand on my own purpose. Yes, I am retired, but I want to always keep being involved in the community, and especially on issues on education. That is very close to my heart. I had the opportunity to visit every school in the county since I moved here. I look at some of the needs very closely. I'm grateful for many of the people that are here tonight that welcome me into the county and help connect those dots. And I find myself now at 70 years old, 71, trying to continue to connect and to look at the senior citizen community to embrace what we are trying to do here tonight. In 1958, Alamance County voters approved a $6.5 million school bond. At that time, and I quote from a Time and News article, education should not be looked upon as an expense, but rather as an investment. That was said in the 50s. I would like to quote some excerpts from a letter to the editor of the Times and News, but was never published, from one of my neighbors, Louis Hibbert. He's here tonight, and he's asking, what are the benefits that will be obtained from this education bond? He wrote, quote, cost and benefits, the trade-off always exists, probably have some impact on taxes, but what will be the cost to those same residents in the bond if the bond does not pass? Companies that provide jobs in the upper end of the pay scale place a premium on the quality of life of their employees. They need to enjoy quality education being paramount. That's end of quote. I personally have always been an advocate for Alamance County, and it's my duty as a senior citizen to invest in our schools after so many years of neglect. We are building step by step our future. Our children are going to be sitting there where you are. Did we give them the tools, a good environment to be able to learn and succeed? We need to invest in public education. Young families will choose to live elsewhere. Not having a growing population of younger citizens, we lose the vitality that we need as a community to maintain our quality of life. It is time to put the bond in its full amount on the ballot, so we have the opportunity to show the support of this investment in our children's future. I pledge here tonight to continue work to make this bond a reality in this election period. We cannot, as senior citizens, sit and wait. And as Mr. Dan Engel said at the community council meeting last month, we cannot pile children in our schools' buildings like cords of wood. He just made it very visual to me. Thank you for letting me speak tonight.
Next is Paul Koontz. Is Paul Koontz here? I don't see Paul. Paul Koontz? Okay, go ahead, Zach. Oh, the next person after Paul is Mr. Passion. Dazon Passion? Is he here? Here's Paul. Great. Sorry. Mr. Passion, just hold on back there, please. Mr. Koontz is here, so he's going to go ahead, but you will be in the next one. All right, Zach, when you're ready, thank you.
Hello. I would like to thank you all for allowing me to speak and for the great work you commissioners do. My name is Zach Clemens, and I am a current 10th grader at Southern Alamance High School. I'm also the representative for an organization called the NCASC, or North Carolina Association of Student Councils. I currently hold the position of president-elect of the NCASC. My school, Southern, is the president-elect school. What this means is that in the year 2020, we will be holding a convention at this high school that you are sitting in right now. I would like to talk to you about the NCASC, the convention, and Southern's facilities. The NCASC is an organization of student councils across the state divided into three districts, Eastern, Central, and Western. There are thousands of students connected to the NCASC, and hundreds of students attend the state conventions each year. The office of president-elect that Southern and I hold will next March turn over into the office of president and president school. The president school holds the state convention. What this means is that upwards of 600 students will travel to come across the state to Alamance County. Local hotels will be filled up, local businesses will have a chance to advertise to people from across the state, and Alamance County will have a chance to showcase the absolute best qualities of our community and other counties across the state. I have attended an NCASC state convention for 2 years now, and I can say that our school is behind other present schools that I have seen. Our facilities are in desperate need of improvements and renovations. We need to make improvements to Southern if we want to show the rest of the state the best that Alamance County has to offer. I urge you to consider improving our cafeteria, which will have to hold upwards of 600 kids and adults for multiple meals. Our bathrooms and hallways in general need to be renovated. We have wallpaper peeling and water damage in many of our classrooms. I can't walk into some of the closets and classrooms because of my asthma that I've had since I was born. I urge you to show the rest of the state how amazing Alamance County is by showing them the best our schools can look. The renovation of Southern will not only affect Southern Alamance. Local businesses will be positively affected because people across the state will remember the amazing food and great facilities Southern had during the 2020 state convention. They will remember the beautiful hotels they stayed at and Southern Alamance itself. I tell you from my own personal experience that the better a school looks, the better the overall experience is. Again, I would like to thank you for your hard work, and I greatly appreciate your time.
Thank you, Zach. Mr. Kuntz, if you will start. Mr. Pazion, if you will come forward, please.
Good evening. My name is Paul Kuntz, P-A-U-L-K-O-O-N-T-S, 304 Travis Lane in Gibsonville. I'm an attorney with Ortel, Kuntz, and Ortel. And it's always wonderful to hear our students show up and speak. I think they always should be listened to and part of this process. I was very involved over the years in the development of the vision plan for public education, which of course the county commissioners adopted as well. And I really view this bond referendum as the next step in the community being able to speak on how they value education in our community. In case I don't get to it, I'm in full support of putting the full amount of the bond referendum, but for both ABSS and for ACC, on the ballot and letting everyone from Gibsonville to Mebane, I always like to say from McRae's to Ye Olde Country Kitchen, vote on this. And let the community in the most democratic process, little d, available, speak on the ballot and say, this is what we want for the future of Alamance County. We know that growth is wonderful, but is also a challenge. You heard Ed Hooks from Mebane speaking about this. I represent the town of Swepsonville as well. That growth in the southern part of the county is tremendous. People are coming, and we need to manage that growth. And to manage that growth, we need to have a plan for our facilities, not just the schools, not just ACC, but all the county facilities as well. So as part of this process, and I'm glad that the county is working so hard to help develop that and move forward with those plans. But really what it comes down to is talent. We are in a constant battle as a community to attract and retain talent. And because we want folks to come here and start businesses, be entrepreneurs, hire from our schools, and those entrepreneurs need young people who can have critical thinking skills and can grow. And that's all, that's not just tech, and that's not just the glamorous things, that's the trades as well. And we're doing a much better job in our school system addressing those needs. I want to be able to attract the best talent possible, keep them here in Alamance County, and see those small businesses and entrepreneurs succeed. So I'd leave you with four things tonight. Number one, we have the borrowing capacity to do both of these bonds completely. We know that. We have the ability, the legal ability to borrow that money. Let's put the ABSS and ACC bonds completely on the ballot. Number two, I'd ask you to, as part of this, continue to develop a comprehensive strategic plan regarding all facilities in the county, the county buildings, the school buildings, and every part of that. Maintenance is a big issue and is an ongoing cost, and we need to plan for that. Number three, I want you to take the steps in your budget to make sure that we try to improve our bond rating, because that lowers our cost of borrowing. And number four, I think you should utilize the retail infrastructure that the cities and the county have helped build over time. Because, of course, DOT puts the roads in, the cities help put the water and the sewer in, to Alamance Crossing, to Tanger. And let's put the sales tax portion of this on the ballot so that everyone can decide that. But using other people's money is a good thing in this sense. We've already put the money in the ground to build those retail facilities. Let's use the revenue from it as well. Thank you.
All right, the next on the list is Norlander Aldean Jr. If he's here, he will come forward. Thank you. Mr. Passion.
Good evening, Chair Gailey and members of the board. My name is Dayson Passion, DaySonPassion, and I'm a resident of Alamance County, 609 West Front Street, Burlington, 27215. 17 years ago, I was able to address an audience in this room. It was one of our senior year events, and while there were many people, there will be three people there that I will distinctly remember. They were my science teachers throughout high school, Ms. Quakenbush, Mr. Sturdivant, and Mr. Blevins. These teachers were able to shape an interest into a passion, so much so that I decided to teach science here in ABSS, and I am now the STEAM coordinator and instructional technology facilitator at Graham Middle School. I say this to say that as you consider the bond, know that we need to update our facilities and programs to better serve our students so that they will be better equipped to compete in a world where STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math drives our economy and society. I can see daily with my students how STEM can engage and create wonder and curiosity in our students' lives. They are becoming empowered learners, digital citizens, knowledge constructors, innovative designers, computational thinkers, creative communicators, and global collaborators. STEM is important. STEM is an economic driver. STEM presents opportunity. There needs to be more people ready to meet such opportunity. Our facilities need to be at a place where teachers and students can experience and utilize STEM equipment and practices before leaving their K-12 experience. As a board, you have also made STEM a priority. It may not be explicitly stated in the county's strategic vision, but STEM is a crucial component of each of the county's action pillars. As a Keenan Fellow, I've had the privilege to work side by side with leaders in STEM. As a Seaman STEM Fellow, I've been able to incorporate the future of STEM into classrooms of today, but I'm just one teacher and my effect size is limited. You, on the other hand, have a much greater effect size. Tonight, you can begin to change the future of almost 23,000 students. Our students and community deserve better facilities and STEM opportunities. I want to remind you of your awesome responsibility for the people of Alamance County. As representatives, you often get the deciding vote on policies of this county. In your discussions, you often state that you have to remember to take into consideration all members of the community, not just your friends and associates, not just the people who came here tonight to speak, not just those that write letters to the editors or post on Facebook. You are here to represent all. I can think of no better way to allow all county residents the opportunity to be heard on these two bonds than by letting them cast and record their votes. Please put the bonds on the ballot in the upcoming general election for the full amount being requested of $150 million. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Passion. Is John Dooley here? Mr. Dooley is here. Go ahead.
Hello. My name is Norlander Aldean Jr., Norlander Aldean Jr. I am the student body president at Western Alamance High School. Nearly 3 years ago, I moved to Alamance County from Charleston, West Virginia. It has been a very positive experience being in ABSS. I was able to play sports and get involved in student council. The Western student body has great school spirit. Unfortunately, I've noticed, compared to my school in West Virginia, Western's facilities are old and no longer sufficient. It's hard to keep school spirit if we can't be proud of our school. Recently, our student council was able to travel to Alexandria Central High School to be honest, I was jealous to hear about the facilities that they had. Every day, I read the morning announcements at school. My classmates constantly say they can't hear me over the announcements. I think it's very important if we up those systems in case we had an emergency. This makes it very hard to keep our community involved and our students involved in great events that we have across the campus. As an athlete, I have experienced firsthand facilities from Guilford County and Orange County. They were able to host both JV girls and JV boys, JV varsity boys and varsity girls in one night. Western was the host of the basketball conference tournament this year. We couldn't even fit the schools alone that had the game in one game. We had to tell people they couldn't come in or they had to stand out in the lobby. Together, we must decide what we want for the future of Alamance County. Passing this bond would send a graphic message to all the students across that we deserve the best. And for those worried about what it may cost, remember Benjamin Franklin said, an investment is knowledge. An investment in knowledge pays the best interest.
Thank you, Mr. Dean. Next is Stacy Johnson. Stacy Johnson here. You may begin when you're ready.
My name is John Dooley, J-O-N-D-O-O-L-E-Y. I'm a resident and taxpayer in this county and a parent of two children in ABSS, an eighth grader and a third grader. I am also one of the 1,600 employees of Elon University, where I serve as a vice president for student life and a member of Connie Book's senior staff. As one of the major employers in the county, the university is deeply committed to public education, and we have developed some outstanding partnerships together. A high-quality public school system is an essential attribute of a thriving community. I know that whenever we are trying to bring a new employee and their family to this community, inevitably one of the early questions that is often asked is about the schools. It doesn't take someone long to do their homework and realize we have some wonderful programs occurring in this county, but our facilities do not support or match our aspirations. We have to give students the space they need to learn. We are over capacity in our high schools, and the number of students attending those schools is projected to increase rapidly. Most of our school buildings in this county were built between the Truman and Ford administrations. And many no longer provide a safe or healthy environment for our children, much less the technology needed for 21st century science and technology education. This is not about peeling paint. My daughter attends a middle school where 2 years ago, one of the walkways in the school was condemned. Think about that. Decades of neglect by the county board mean that we now have to address deferred maintenance, electrical systems, restrooms, sidewalks, handrails, asbestos flooring tiles, and other structural issues. In front of you tonight, you have the ABSS bond referendum, which is critical to the future of our county. I know there are a few of you on this county board who do not personally support investing more in our schools. I simply request put the bond referendum before the voters in this county in November and let the community decide. Prior generations invested in schools for us, and now it is our turn to put forth this bond referendum that will result in nominal tax implications for Alamance County, but reap tremendous benefits for our future. On behalf of a key partner from Elon University, my colleagues and their families, we join the others here tonight asking you to set a strong course for the future of this county. The institutions, businesses, and people of this county want you to invest in our future, to invest in a high-quality education for our children, and to make decisions that will support the economic future of our community. On behalf of those institutions and businesses, and on behalf of the children of this county, I urge you this evening to vote unanimously to send the ABSS bond referendum toward the voters without amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dooley. Jeff Andrews, thank you. Go ahead when you're ready.
Hi, my name is Stacy Johnson, S-T-A-C-E-Y, Johnson, J-O-H-N-S-O-N. I live in Elon and teach English as a second language at Elon Elementary School. Thank you for the opportunity to speak this evening on behalf of the good teachers of ABSS. Good teachers, they get to know their students. They care about their well-being and strive to increase lifetime opportunities for them. Good teachers offer a strong and sound education that students can rely on when they seek to achieve personal and professional goals. Good teachers continuously work outside of school hours to complete data reports and to seek and cater assignments to student-specific needs, skills, and interests. They know that igniting student interest and a love of learning is essential. Good teachers weave lessons that emphasize social justice. They promote courtesy and responsibility, perseverance, courage, good judgment, integrity, respect, and self-discipline. Good teaching is time-consuming. It is a constant curiosity about how we can help students to learn and digest and grow empowered to improve their life circumstances. These are the students in ABSS. In ABSS, good teaching is at work, but we are working within a system starving for resources. This is during a time when adequate public school funding is dependent upon the local financial supplements from the community. We need this bond at its full value, not a penny less than $150 million. It's the bare minimum to improve our school system for our good teachers. We need to put this financial decision in front of the voters. The needs are simple, starting with the need for another high school building, additional learning space in older buildings, updated science labs and programs to increase student interest, knowledge, and support as they grow ready to compete in our global society. Many things happening right now, such as the creative management of our overcrowding schools and the lack of opportunity in our outdated facilities, is quite ridiculous. Yet, good teachers continue at bat for their students daily. This year alone, I have written 3 grant proposals, have spent my own money to start an after-school Spanish club for native speakers, and have networked to identify supplemental resources available to my students, such as free tutoring through Elon University and reduced-rate music lessons through El Sistema. This is what good teachers do, and ABSS is full of good teachers. Without question, we need full funding from the bond to bring our schools up to par. Just up to standard from decades of neglect and lower than expected taxes. Currently, good teachers are doing what they need to do to teach our children well. A student teacher I was speaking with in the teacher's lounge recently, and I enthusiastically asked her, "Oh, are you going to stay in the area?" And her response was, "I'd be hard-pressed to do that." And it was heartbreaking. It really was heartbreaking because our students deserve good teachers. Currently, many parents with extra resources choose to homeschool, to send their children to charters, or to private schools. Until our public schools are truly the best option for everyone, with clean and stable places of learning, and facilities and technology adequate for the current population, it is my job as a good teacher to advocate for better. We must achieve better in our system. It's what our great students deserve. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Tony Forrest, thank you. Go ahead, Mr. Andrews.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Jeff Andrews, JeffAndrews. I live at 818 Warwick Court in Burlington. And I'm part of that growing demographic of retired senior citizen. You've heard a lot of comments tonight about reasons why we need this bond, and we need this bond to be fully funded. I stand squarely in that camp that supports this bond and it being fully funded. But I want to use my time tonight to talk a little bit about the process, and you've heard some other speakers talk about this as well, but I've been following this process of schools coming before this body for probably 40 years now, and all too often it seems to work this way, that the schools come and they need money for a special project, or they need money to improve projects that they have dealing with facilities and other things that the county has the responsibility to fund. And the answer always seems to be from whoever happens to be sitting in your place at the time the request comes. It's, you know, I really support public education, but we just don't have the money. And you ask us to delay, or you ask us to take a lesser amount of money. And when I question that decision, why is it you don't have the money? Why can't you fund this? The answer often is, well, we can't raise the tax rate. The voters would never support that. When I delve deeper, how do you know what the voters are going to support? They say, well, we had comments at a commissioner's meeting, and more of the speakers were against it than were for it. Well, I don't think that's happened tonight. Another comment will be, well, I got more emails and more telephone calls that were against the proposal than were for the proposal. Once again, that's an awfully small sampling, and that's nothing more than anecdotal evidence. But so what I say, and what many other people who have spoken tonight say, is now you have the opportunity to really find out what the voters want. You don't have to guess. You don't have to depend on 10 emails or three comments at a meeting like this. Put the issue on the ballot for full funding and see exactly what the electorate wants. Let me just finish up. I heard this comment once, and it said that vision without execution is hallucination. We've got the vision. You've seen the vision plan. You've seen all the planning that has gone into this for the construction of a new school, for the remodeling of other schools. So much work, so much vision has gone into it. Please let us have a chance to execute that plan. Put it on the ballot for full funding. Thank you very much.
Job Williamson. Job, I can't see you around over there. Can't make
you're next,
give Job. You a nod. You're next. Thank you. Mr. Forrest.
Madam Chair, members of the Board of Commissioners, good evening. My name is Tony Forrest, F-O-R-I-E-S-T. My address is 2211 Quail Drive in Graham, North Carolina. And I'm not running for anything. Thank you all for the opportunity to be with you. And it has been a while since I've had the privilege of addressing you all. And I understand that my time is limited, so I will be brief. I have been involved in this community all of my life, and like you, my passion is serving in some kind of way. Even today, I wear a number of different hats as I try to make a positive difference in Alamance County. The common denominator in all that I do is the promotion of educational opportunities and success for every student in Alamance County. Today, I do not represent any of these wonderful organizations, but I come to you as a private citizen, as a father, a husband, a taxpayer, and a patriot of Alamance County. In my humble opinion, there is no greater gift that can be given to our young minds than the opportunity for the best education that this community can provide. We are at a crossroads right now. Numerous options are available to us as a community. And let me just be very clear about this. We can fund education or not. We can either step up to the financial needs of our schools and young people, or we can choose to kick the can down the road and hope that someone else will show the courage to make the tough decisions later. My guess is that you all will do what is expected of effective leadership. My own children have long since graduated from our system, and they have taken their places in their respective communities. My wife and I have decided to continue to support this community that we hope to call home for a very long time to come. The price that I pay the price that we pay for living in the best community in the world, is paid with no regrets. To ensure that your grandchildren and that my grandchildren have the best that Alamance County can provide by way of opportunity means that someone has to make a sacrifice. Someone has to make an investment in our future. Let us give ourselves and the citizens of this community the opportunity to do what we can to make a difference for someone else. The school bonds are vital to the immediate needs of our schools, for sure, but by making educational resources and opportunities available across the county, we increase the likelihood that education initiatives from cradle to career will be maximized. This bond will be the first of many choices that will distinguish the difference in how well this county will thrive and survive in the next generation. And again, I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Forrest. After Job, we have Dr. Boylston. If you would make your way forward. Go ahead, Job.
Thank you so very much. My name is Job Williamson, J-O-B-W-I-L-L-I-A-M-S-O-N. That's not Job. I live on 904 Hunt Street in Burlington, North Carolina, 27217. I am the student body president at Walter M. Williams High School. The M stands for McAdoo. And I will take you back to a month ago where we had a very important opportunity to walk out of our school system. Now, I'm in a school building. It was not a walkout against gun control, no. It was a walkout for remembrance of those who lost their lives. And I called every one of you all. Some didn't answer. That's all right. I left messages. I have talked to Mr. Bird, Ms. Gailey, and so on and so on. As student body president of Walter Williams High School, one of my duties as president is to engage with my peers. And on that day, March 14th, I had a chilling realization of what happened and what's going on in our school system. My English 4 honors teacher, Ms. Betsy Lee, asked a very serious question in our journals, and that question was, do you feel safe in your own school? And we raised our hands, and the majority was, no, they do not feel safe in their own schools. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was a parent, I wouldn't have sent a kid to a school system where a majority of the kids don't even feel safe in their own school building. Now, in this bond, it has talked about how we will improve the building structure, how we're going to add on. But one thing that's been overlooked by the whole thing is what it's going to do about the doors. Many of our schools have doors that are open and unlocked. Now, as being Walter Williams High School, we are centrally in the middle of the heart of Burlington. And so we have very elderly people that walk around their dogs to get exercise, which is fine. We have people that walk in up and down Bulldog Alley to get exercise. We're not saying cut them away. We're not saying get rid of them. They are a part of our community. So we want them to be in our community and be able to walk around Williams. But we also have to realize that we have students there as well. We don't know what the intentions are of some of those people. It could be anyone. And so what it says, and I'm so fortunate to be on the advisory board, of Superintendent Advisory Board for Student Council. And one of the things he showed us was the automatic door locks, the key fobs that our teachers will be able to have to send a student out that needs to go to the car if they drive, or even just go to the office and get back inside. That will cut down so many acts of violence against our students, and that will save many of our students' lives. I don't want to be in college and I hear about my school system that I fought so much and I talked so highly of for the past 3 years, 4 years, just to hear them on the CNN news talking about a shooting. That is devastating, and I wouldn't want a parent to go through that loss of a child. I say to you now, and I know we're hitting a dead horse. I mean, everybody's been saying it over and over. Give us an opportunity, and we will show you. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Joe. Next is Carol Raggett. Tara Raggett, if you would come forward, please. You may begin when you're ready, Dr. Boylston.
Good evening. Thank you so much, our commissioners and members of our community. My name is Yun Boylston, Y-U-N, last name B-O-Y-L-S-T-O-N, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. I'd like to speak on behalf of my fellow board members of the Alamance Chamber, and as such, I would like to read this written statement that was approved by the Chamber Board April 12th, 2018. And first, I would also like to acknowledge the tremendous work from the folks at Davenport in providing us with the expertise and the financial analysis that really gave us good information as the bond moves forth. So the directors, or the board of directors of the Alamance Chamber has voted unanimously to request that the commissioners approve each bond measure, being ABSS and Alamance Community College, at the full amounts proposed. In addition, the Chamber Board requests that the quarter cent sales tax be included as an option for generating revenue to help pay for the bonds, and that the commissioners approve adding that measure on the ballot. The Alamance Chamber has a long history of representing and providing the support of the business community to the efforts of our local education institutions, Alamance Burlington School System, Alamance Community College, and Elon University. The Alamance Chamber takes the position that education and economic development are tied together in such a way that one cannot be successful without the other. Our local educational institutions are expected to help prepare our young people to become productive citizens wherever they go and whatever they do, many of whom become the local labor force so critical to the success of our local businesses. In addition, high-performing educational institutions are critical infrastructure for a high quality of life in the community, which businesses need to ensure a sustainable, vibrant local economy. Alamance County is growing, and it is time to make significant investments in our community's educational infrastructure, not only in response to current growth demands, but also in preparation for the demands of future growth and changes in society and technology, which will require people to have more education for future jobs. Now, I'd like to spend the rest of the time, if I may, speaking as a pediatrician at Burlington Pediatrics and Mebane Pediatrics, and also as the mom of three children who are current students in ABSS. I'm not sure if members of our audience have had a chance to look through the facility assessment study. It's on the ABSS website, and I would encourage everyone to read through it and see the kinds of things that are being proposed. I'll read some to you now. Replacement of concrete canopy columns to prevent failure. Remove asbestos floor tiles. Remove missing or install missing handrails. Remediate the cracking in concrete masonry block walls. Replace failing window systems. Now, these are a few, and they're actually collected through at least five of the high schools that are included in that in the proposal. Now, I don't know of anyone here who would choose to put their parents into a nursing home that's described like this. And yet we require our children to attend school there every day, right? So our children and our teachers. And part of our economic development here, and we have community members who are so good at this. We have the Alamance Chamber, we have all of our business leaders, and they have a very specific role in recruitment, recruiting businesses, but we also have a role too. Whether it's intended or not, our children receive a message every day. Are we recruiting them or are we rejecting them, right? Let's give them the message that we support them. We want them here. These children, they're our future entrepreneurs, our technicians, our nurses. Given all the opportunities in the world, give them a reason to stay here and that we are working towards a prosperous collective future together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Boylston. Taylor, let me start when you're ready.
Good evening, Tara Raggett, T-A-R-A-R-A-G-G-E-T-T, 2427 Colorado Drive, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. My birthday's November 20th, so if you want to send me a birthday card, I accept cash. Okay. In thinking about what I should say this evening, I thought about what drives me to be here, and it always comes back to one thing, and that's the current and future students of ABSS. I'm trying to guide you to understand that most people don't have the luxury of time to be here and express the need for this bond. Therefore, they need another option. The following are the duties of the Board of Education: determine the need and seek funds for the operation, support, maintenance, improvement of the school system, provide for planning, expansion, improvement, financing, construction, and maintenance, prescribe the minimum standards needed for the efficient operation and improvement of the school system. Kudos to our Board of Education. I know that this was a long and tedious process, and I have much respect for what they did. The following are the commissioner's responsibilities and duties: adopt an annual budget, establish a tax rate, appoint a county manager, establish local ordinances, appoint representatives. The following are the commissioner's code of ethics: governmental decisions must be made and implemented through proper channels. Elected officials must maintain integrity and independence, yet are responsive to the interests and needs of those they represent. Elected officials must remain aware they play different roles. As advocates who strive to advance the legitimate needs of their citizens, as legislators who balance public interest and private rights, as fair and impartial decision makers making quasi-judicial and administrative decisions. In order to adhere to and execute the duties and responsibilities of the Board of Education, its members have unanimously made a request through the proper channels for a bond in the amount of $150 million. Based on the commissioner's duties and responsibilities, it's now your responsibility to follow through with the democratic process and put this bond on the ballot. It's for the citizens to decide and vote upon. According to the commissioner's ethics, rhetoric rebuttals based on alleged personal hearsay, such as from what people have told me, and personal opinions, such as I only see teachers here or this auditorium is not filled up, are not valid reasons for refusing to advance the legitimate needs of the citizens. Decisions made on such rhetoric are not fair or impartial, but rather based on your own standards, unethical. Ignoring this request or to strip it down to a lower amount based on personal opinion is not just unethical and outside the duties and responsibilities of the commissioners, but it impedes upon the democratic process. This bond is a professional request from educational experts to ensure decisions in this county are made ethically and within the democratic process. The bond must be voted on by the citizens. On behalf of the current and future students of ABSS, I'm requesting you adhere to the commissioner's duties and responsibilities, ethical standards, democratic process, and put this bond on the ballot for the full amount of $150 million. I'm going to get away with this one more time. I will finish with a quote from Dr. Harrison's childhood friend, FDR. Who once stated, "Let us never forget that government is ourselves and not an alien power over us. The ultimate rulers of our democracy are not a president, senator, congressman, or government official. The ultimate rulers are the voters of this country. Let the voters decide on this."
Next is Erica Johnson. Erica Johnson. Is Erica Johnson here? Erica Johnson. I see people getting up. I don't know if any of them is Erica Johnson.
This is Erica.
Here she is. Okay, great. Thank you. You may go ahead, Taylor.
My name is Taylor Coffey, TaylorCoffey, and I live on 4637 Meadowlark Court in Burlington, 27215. I am the current student body president here at Southern Alamance High School. I am a senior and will be attending UNC Chapel Hill in the fall. I'll repeat the first part again. I am a senior. I am a senior, and I still have to worry about the future of ABSS. So you might be wondering why I care. My brother is in the back of the room, and he is listening to me speak. I was raised in the Alamance Burlington school system all the way from kindergarten to now. And my brother is 5 years old. He will grow up in the school system the same way I did. And my sister, before passing away, was brought up as an ABSS student as well. My mother is an EC teacher within ABSS, and my father, just like me, was raised in this area and even attended Cummings High School, which I think says a lot about the age of our facilities. What I'm trying to get at is the fact that my family has deep roots here in Alamance County. We've experienced many parts of this community, the good and the bad. But overall, that is what this is, a community.
The students brought up in the school system are going to be part of our community for a long time. And we have to worry about whether or not we have the money to support them. Our students are going to become our mechanics, our teachers, our county commissioners, our leaders, and our school should be able to support such dreams. We, as students, should not have to worry about our structure falling on top of us. I know a few months ago, the ceiling in the band room, which is just down the hall, fell through. But we got lucky because it happened at night and our students weren't there. This summer, myself and three other girls spent a good chunk of our time painting the senior wall. It's beautiful and it's on the south side of campus if you'd like to see, and it does a really good job at covering the cracks in the brick because paint is cheaper than cement. But our columns, the ones that hold up the structure of our school, the bottom of them are chipped and eroding away, and paint isn't going to fix that. So if you want the students to work on these problems and fix the falls in our schools and within our community, we would love to. The only thing we ask is that we are funded the way we deserve to be. Thank you.
Valerie Sellers. Thank you. You may start.
Good evening. I am Erica Johnson, E-R-I-C-A-J-O-H-N-S-O-N, and I stand here tonight on behalf of Alamance Burlington Association of Educators. We have expectations of you as you serve your roles and in your positions as our county commissioners. We expect you to give our students the schools that they deserve. I see signs in neighborhoods that say drive as if your kids live here. We expect you to vote for this bond as if your kids attend schools here. As Dr. Harrison mentioned in his presentation, this is the least amount asked, and it does not address all the issues. It's unfair that our students and teachers, that some of our schools are overcapacitated. This means that some of our students aren't getting the attention they deserve, and our teachers want to reach every student. So Ms. Gailey, at whatever cost it is to build a new high school, our students are worthy. You spoke of your constituents and of you listening and representing them. Many sat in confusion because everyone that spoke that night spoke in favor of our strategic plan, yet you voted against it. Which constituents were you speaking of and representing exactly? You ran on an education campaign, and many educators supported you. All we ask is that the support be reciprocated. Also on that night, we recall Sheriff Terry Johnson requesting funds for new cars and data system. There was no hesitation on the vote. My question is, have you already decided our children's fate? Not only is there too much money spent on landfills, but also too much on our jails and prison system. Education is priority. Let's stop saying our children and our students are our future. They are our right now. As Thomas Carlyle advised, our main business is not to see what lies dimly at the distance, but what lies clearly at hand. Our students, educators, and school facilities lie at hand. Let's stop being a society that is reactionary and be one that is preventative. We would rather save a few dollars to balance the budget than pay millions of dollars to reverse a tragedy that could have been prevented. Please do not put this off for future commissioners. Do what's right by our students and do it now. Our children need to believe that they are needed and that we are here to remind you adults that our students all have something to contribute and our precious resources to be nurtured and cherished. So let's give them the schools that they deserve.
Thank you. Ms. Sellers, before you start, the public hearing is an opportunity for anyone to be heard, even if you haven't signed up ahead of time. So if there is someone in the audience who would like to be heard, if you would like to make your way to the microphone and avail yourself of the opportunity, that would be appropriate and fine now. Can you go ahead and start, Ms. Sellers?
Valerie Sellers, V-A-L-E-R-I-E-S-E-L-L-A-R-S. 3132 Sundance Drive, Burlington. Madam Chair and School Board,
I stand before you as a STEM program specialist at Graham High School. The most significant opportunities for future job growth in the field of science, math, technology, and engineering lies with U.S. companies that are struggling to find these highly qualified laborers to fill these positions. Many of these jobs are in North Carolina, and many of them are in Alamance County. The bonds will allow us to build a new high school with state-of-the-art technology and remodel existing high schools to provide a foundation for students going on into these careers and encourage other students to consider these fields. For a few moments, I just want to share a glimpse of what funding can do. The success of new science laboratories at Graham High School, just recently built in 2017, was by grant funding. It's a great example of how they change students' lives. Our new STEM wing has 4 remodeled laboratories, 2 classrooms, and an outdoor learning environment. These facilities provide an environment for rigorous, student-centered, contextualized instruction. Classrooms have industry-standard laboratory equipment that enables students to exhibit behaviors of scientists and engineers as they work in collaborative workspaces. The impact of this grant funding was improved student behaviors and performance in science. Students are authentically engaged in instruction. They've increased their use of laboratory skills and already are ahead of others who will be graduating from high school with these experiences. Technology has allowed teachers to embrace a pedagogy of learning as facilitators. One-to-one Chromebooks where students can share documents with each other, create and analyze data. Augmented reality, they can take a trip to the Barrier Reef, observe, collect, and find data. They've also went to the solar system to see auroras, built Lego robotics to solve problems for missions. The personal impact for students is many, many aha moments. Students are saying, science is my favorite class. We get to do things. We design, we improve, and we get to keep trying, and we never give up. Career pathways are developed. Seniors are now wanting to embrace scientific research because they work with teams, they work with partners. In a genetics unit, bacterial transformation and how it relates to genetically modified organisms. It's not just a term, but it's a reality for these students. In our weather unit, students can calculate real-time weather data, have the technology to be official weather spotter stations. Students now view themselves as scientists. Their enthusiasm is like firecrackers at the end of a fireworks show, where one after another, the excitement bursts. What has only happened in these last few months at Graham High School is only a glimpse of the impact of what funding can do for schools. As a result of this grant, these children are better prepared for economic success in the future, expanding resources that will help give them opportunities. One of our granting funders said, you send a signal to those young people that they matter. And I think if we give that signal to our young people, they're going to be worth every dollar. So we ask the commissioners to put the full amount of the bond to the ballot to give the community the opportunity to support students and the success in Alamance County. Just watch and see the next generation of biotech scientists that will come from Alamance Burlington Schools.
Thank you, Ms. Sellers. Mr. McCain, go ahead and start.
Good evening, County Commissioners, community leaders, ABSS colleagues, and the citizens of Alamance County. My name is Freebird McKinney. We are here tonight to speak to you about our community.
Mr. McKinney, could you spell your name for us?
Sure. F-R-E-E-B-I-R-D, McKinney, M-C-K-I-N-N-E-Y.
Thank you. I'm sorry to interrupt.
No problem. We are here tonight to speak to you about our community, this community that we all share, that we all desire to see grow and prosper, this community that we all collectively have the responsibility and duty to serve and support. We are also here tonight to echo the united voice of its citizenry, allowing us to create the future we all envision for Alamance County, a vision of prosperity and equality for the youth of this county. We believe that everyone here tonight is united in this effort. We are all witnessing the growth of our community. And as Mac Williams explained to the audience of the Alamance Citizens for Education Breakfast several weeks ago, Alamance County is experiencing an emerging period of economic growth. We see it in our economic boom. We see it in the thousands of new residences being built along the I-40 and I-85 corridor. We see it in the international recognition of Alamance Regional Medical Center, Elon University, Glen Raven, LabCorp, and GKN Industry. We also heard from Dr. Gatewood and Dr. Harrison about the innovative programs ACC and ABSS offer our students, the many ways that we are engaging the future citizens of our county in their preparation for their future, be that university, military, or skilled job development. The list is inspiring, and it is greatly benefiting the recruitment of employees and future employers to our community. However, as Mr. Forrest alluded to earlier, we have arrived at a crossroads, a decision that will impact the future of our community. As Commissioner Gailey and I spoke on Saturday at the Homegrown Festival, honoring Alamance County's rich history of agriculture and the students who participate with the Future Farmers of America, we discussed the continuing need to provide engaging programs for all of our students. These decisions are precipitated on the understanding that we must provide the most basic foundational elements for these to exist. Our students require up-to-date buildings, or at least repaired and maintained buildings, in order to thoroughly facilitate their learning, their growing, and actualizing within these programs. And in this very geographical area, southeastern Alamance County, our students require a new high school, one that can support, encourage, and nurture the physical growth of our population, but also the intellectual and technological development of their future endeavors. Our community is in support of these changes. Our citizenry understands the foresight required to make these changes for our children, for the students of ACC and ABSS. We stand here tonight asking you all to be the leaders for our community that we need. For the many here in attendance, but also for the thousands of others who exercise their right to vote for you to be their voice, we have reached the moment when we can no longer turn our backs on our community. We can no longer accept outdated and antiquated facilities, even mindsets that do not consider the future of our community. We are no longer quaint or sleepy. We have evolved from a one-town county. We are not just growing, but we have grown. Burlington, Graham, and Mebane are now individually composed cities that collectively represent our community. We are ready to make the changes necessary to become what we are becoming. Today is the day to begin this process, to publicly support this bond, to reclaim your voice of leadership in our community by uniting all of us in the shared future, one that starts with our children, with the brick and mortar that supports our schools and our college, and with the promise of hope for Alamance County, our community, and its path of progress. In essence, let us, our community, vote. Thank you for your time and your leadership and your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. McKinney. Go ahead.
My name is Latifa Hodge, LATEEFAHHAJEH. I am a freshman at Eastern Alamance High School, and I wish for change there because during Ever since I got there, I've seen a lot of people get hurt, not just random people, like my friends mostly. I had to start bringing Band-Aids and like first aid things because overcrowding there is such a problem. Everyone's trying to get to their class in time and they're being shoved all the way through. So then everyone's like, hey, do you have a Band-Aid or something? Or do you have something I could cover this up? And most of the time, teachers don't have it because they don't have that kind of supplies. So that's why I started getting it. And hand sanitizer too, because sometimes if someone goes to the bathroom or if they blow their nose or something, there isn't the supplies there that's needed. And hygiene and the facilities in the school aren't how you think they are, because the stalls are broken, the bathrooms most of the time don't work. Some people stopped even going to the bathroom. They just hold it in through the whole day. And I don't think that's right, because school's supposed to be a second home, sort of. And it's supposed to be a nice place, a good place to learn. And it's supposed to have things that can help you acknowledge all the learning that is around you. And there isn't a lot of resources there that the teachers say that they had in the past years. Like, now half the time in our biology class, we don't even have the textbooks to write down the information that we need for the unit that we're doing, or we stopped doing labs because we don't have all the little test tubes or whatever liquids that you use. So it's not a lot of learning. All it is cutting, gluing, coloring it and putting it into our notebooks. That's not learning to us. Most of the kids just get it from their friends or say, hey, can you cut this out and I'll glue this for you? It's not learning, it's just busy work. And that's just one of the things. Knowing that I have to bring supplies to help my friends stay like safe in a way and keep them from getting sick, it kind of bothers me knowing that I have little siblings that go to school, and sure, they don't have all the shoving there, but they still get hurt like at the playground or something. And I don't know if the teachers have, not medical, but like safety kits or something like that. And that's a problem. And I know a lot of teachers that I love, and they take money out of their own pocket just to pay for things that they don't have, to replace broken windows. I even know a teacher that bought a very large sheet of it was a sheet of wood because the window in the classroom broke because of storm, and so the school couldn't pay for it at the time, so we had to have that the wooden board there at the window the whole time, and it got replaced every week or so, or if someone messed with it. So that was one of the things we had to do. I remember that it's just an occurrence that happens at the school. It's safety, that's a problem. It's hygiene, that's a problem. And if we had the bond on the ballot, then the schools can decide whether they should, like what they do with the money and how it can help and benefit the school. Because knowing that at some point I am going to graduate and be doing a job of my choice or in the military, then I don't want to have to be worrying about my little sisters and my little brothers in the school thinking, gosh, I hope they're safe, or I hope they have the Band-Aids and the pencils and utensils that they need. So, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hodge.
Good evening. Thank you, County Commissioners, for allowing us to come and speak to you tonight. My name is Laura Miller Mitchell, LauraMiller, Mitchell. May I go to the next round of the spelling bee now? My residence is at 1522 North NC Highway 87, Elon, North Carolina. I've been a proud resident of Alamance County for 18 years, and I also do have 3 children, and yes, my children are ABSS and have been for 10 years, but I actually wanted to take this opportunity, if I might, to speak to you about Alamance Community College, because it is also very close to my heart. I have had the honor and privilege to be a student there for the last 3 years. Yes, I am older than every professor in our department, but that's okay. I enrolled in the fall of 2015, and I will proudly graduate in 2019. I like to tell everyone, I'm so smart, I crammed a two-year program into four. But anyway, when I started at ACC, I'm going to be perfectly honest, it was simply a way to escape being a stay-at-home mom for one day a week, also taking care of my in-laws. I had no intention of getting a college degree because I already have one. Most people keep going up. I went from a BS, now I'm getting an associate's degree. So I actually just started there for fun, and I fell in love with ACC. And here's why. When I went to college 25 years ago, dinosaurs roamed the land, and I was told as a high school student that if I went to a two-year college, I just wasn't shooting high enough. Everyone was encouraged to go to a four-year degree. And that's what I did. And I worked in my field, and then I became a stay-at-home mom. Well, when I went back to ACC, I discovered and relearned what community college was. Community college is hands-on. Half of my class time is spent actually learning about plants with my hands. I'm not just sitting and listening to a PowerPoint. For so many students, that's a valid and exciting way to learn. Another thing that community college has opened my eyes to, especially since I have three children, is it's affordable. I am now a single mom, and I can actually afford to go to ACC where I could not afford to attend a four-year college at this time. And I'm very thankful for that opportunity, and it's right here in Alamance County. I love to tell people all the time that Alamance Community College is our hidden gem. So many people don't realize the quality of education that we're offering students. Just this past month, I hope that you're all aware that the Horticulture Department was honored to host a national landscape competition right here in Alamance Community College. This could have been done at NC State or Colorado State as it has in the past, but we had the chance to bring that here, and it's because of what AC has to offer. That's only been done by a community college twice in this 40-year competition, and it's because of what ACC offers. So yes, I do absolutely believe for the ABSS part of this bond, but I did want to speak on behalf of Alamance Community College, what it has meant to me and my family, the chance to get a quality education that is affordable and right here in our backyard. I ask you to consider putting the full amount on the ballot so that other people in our community that love ACC as much as I do will be able to continue to have that education right here. Thank you so much for your time, commissioners.
Thank you. Mr. Bowen.
Thank you, Commissioner, for the opportunity to come out and speak to you tonight, and all the people here, I'm sure they really appreciate that. My name is Henry Vines, H-E-N-R-Y-V-I-N-E-S. I live at 3450 Isaac Drive, Snow Camp, North Carolina. I've lived here, I'm a lifetime resident, and I do know when the last school was built because I was the first graduating class of Cummins High School in 1972. I'm not here to say that these needs are not needed. They've been needed for over the last 10 years. We have neglected the maintenance and stuff of our schools for many years. Some due to economic times, some just out and out neglect. But we need to always repair and fix our schools as they're needed. Sometimes I wonder if it's the money or if it's the way that it's been managed, the money's being managed, that the maintenance is not being done correctly on these schools as it should. We should never have a hole in a roof. It don't make no difference if the hole's there, fix it, and let the county commissioners, let the school board figure out how they're going to pay for it. But I'm here tonight to speak out. If you fund this plane fully at 150 and 30-some million, close to $200 million, and you're asking, we know, as taxpayers, that we're going to have to pay for this. The original cost of this thing was 13 cents. I know they've done some adjustments and some wiggling around and trying to sugarcoat this thing. But in all essence, you're looking at 13 cents of property value. The silent majority of people out here will not vote for this because of that reason. They're not going to vote in a bond that's going to raise their property taxes by 13 cents. County Commissioners, y'all got a huge job here ahead of you, I know, to decide on what you want to do. There's other options out here that we can do the fundiest. And you need to go after these funds, and you need to let the people of this county know this. A sales tax, a 1 cent sales tax, would pay for this whole bond. If everybody here says that they don't mind paying a little more property tax, then let them pay 1 cent more sales tax. That way it takes the burden of the property off the property owners and puts it on everybody's shoulders. Everybody is getting the benefit of this. So everybody should have to pay. We've got people that's coming into this county using our facilities, our retail facilities. Certainly, let them help us pay for this thing. Commissioners, I support the fact that we need these repairs on these schools. I know we're going to need a new high school down the road, but now might not be the time to put that on there. Because what's going to happen if this bond fails completely? Then we've got nothing. So I would say that you need to look at ways of we can fix these things. And we can fix these things through a sales tax. We can fix these in a year-to-year basis and not have to put nothing to burden on anybody but get the schools fixed. And this is a thing that I think that we need to do, and I hope y'all consider this. I know you got a hard decision to make tonight, but put some kind of option out here. How you going to pay for this? We've got to pay for it, folks. And without something concrete of how we're going to pay this without raising property taxes by 13 cents, you can put it to the vote of the people, but the people will vote it down and we'll be standing with nothing. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Vines. Ms. Braxton.
Good evening. My name is Stephanie Braxton, S-T-E-P-H-A-N-I-E. B-R-A-X-T-O-N, and I live at 511 Edgewood Court in Burlington. I'm the Executive Director of Alamance Citizens for Education. I'm here tonight representing ACE, but also serving the role of a concerned parent, a business owner, and a longtime citizen of Alamance County. You've already heard tonight a lot of what I had planned to say. So in the interest of time, I'm going to skip to the good stuff. On ACE's behalf, I want to thank you. Thank you and the county staff, especially County Manager Brian Haygood. I've had the opportunity to hear his explanation of the capital funding plan. It is evident that you all have done your due diligence regarding the proposed bond referendum. But more importantly, Mr. Haygood has done a great job making it clear that Alamance County can now take on more debt, and we have many options to pay for that debt. We are in a good position to take on more debt. I think you will agree that few things are more important than the future of our children. As a county commissioner, you have the responsibility to the citizens of Alamance County, and that includes all 22,600 ABSS students, our future. Invest in our schools by placing the education bond on the ballot at the full amount requested by our Board of Education. Invest in our teachers by showing them that we are a community that respects and values their work. It's been 20 years or more since a commitment as impressive as this one has been made. I ask you to be bold, be a hero tonight. Now is the time to invest in our students. Now is the time to invest in our schools. Vote yes to the referendum allowing the bonds to be placed on the ballot at the requested amount in full. Let the citizens of Alamance County decide. Thank you.
Mr. Carter, go ahead.
My name is Steve Carter. I live in Burlington, North Carolina. I'm here to speak tonight about this bond. Madam Chair, Commissioners, I appreciate this opportunity for myself and for the people of Alamance County. I think it's fairly obvious that the consensus here tonight is in support of something for the schools being done to fix the problems that we have. The question and the challenge to the commissioners is how to pay for it. How to pay for it in such a way that we don't overburden the taxpayers of Alamance County. Now, that's a tough challenge. I've heard a number of options presented. We've heard options presented in the last several meetings about how to pay for it, different kinds of sales tax revenues, and so on and so forth. Mr. Vines just made a couple of other suggestions, which I thought appeared to be interesting. There are challenges to every single one of these options. You know, what happens to retail revenues if we match the tax rate on retail sales in Guilford and Orange counties? Just a question. There are plenty of questions we've got to deal with. Do we actually still get 60% of our sales tax revenue from outside of Alamance County if we match everybody else? So many issues to deal with. I know it's going to be tough, but I think part of the equation here too is looking in detail at the budget for Alamance County, which you're in the process of looking at, and making sure that we're spending what we have to spend. If we're spending money we don't need on something we don't have to have, that's money that can be used to pay for a bond, which from appearances here tonight might be something the citizens might be interested in. In particular, I know they're interested in improving the schools. If you have a child, a grandchild in the schools here, you want them to have the best. You want them to be in a quality, clean, comfortable facility, something that's conducive to learning. We've got to figure out a way to do that. As citizens in this community and as commissioners in this community, that's your challenge. I appreciate what you're facing. And look forward to seeing what you come up with. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mr. Carter. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Carla Hernandez. I'm a student at Alamance Community College. Thank you for your time. I just wanted to talk to you about my experience at Alamance Community College.
Ms. Hernandez, I'm sorry to interrupt. Could you spell your name, please?
Yes, Carla. So I came to the United States when I was a year old. I've spent all my life here in Alamance County. And throughout high school, I never thought of going to college. That never crossed my mind. Either because I couldn't afford it or it just never crossed my mind. But then I heard about Alamance Community College. At first I was like, I don't know if I'm made for this or I don't know if I can do this. But once I went, took a look at the school, felt like the atmosphere of the school, I fell in love automatically. I had no idea what I wanted to do, but I knew that I wanted to continue my education. And Alamance Community College gave me that opportunity to further my education. And like many people, they don't have the same opportunity to do that. And I'm I really appreciate Alamance Community College for giving me that opportunity. And I know a lot of people in our community go through those things. And again, Alamance Community College is a great place for people that don't have that, or for people to have that second chance of furthering their education. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hernandez. Go ahead and start, please.
Good evening. My name is Valerie Mason, Valerie Mason. I am a current junior at Graham High School, and here are a few facts that I want to settle about the recent problems that I have faced and witnessed over the past 3 years. So I just want you guys to think about plumbing. Plumbing in your home. Say you had to renovate your entire plumbing system. That would be a lot of money, correct? Well, I go down the hall every day smelling the sewer. That's disgusting. Our bathrooms need to be renovated, and the plumbing system needs to be redone. I don't know how old it is, but it is very old to be smelling the sewer. And I think about a week ago, my friend Vanessa, she's the senior class president, she told me a story about how the bathrooms were flooded. The dressing rooms for dance were flooded, and also the bathrooms in F building. That's quite disgusting. I don't think we should be surrounded in that type of environment. Today, in my choral ensemble class, my teacher could not even play a note on the piano due to the humidity in the room. How am I supposed to learn music without the piano working? I could go on the list about how many renovations that need to be made at Graham High School, and not only just my school, but also all of the schools of Alamance County. On behalf of the students and the faculty, I'm sure it is made clear that these renovations need to be made, and that the this bond needs to be clearly met to the standard that we need. It's not that, oh, it's just too much money. Well, that money is specifically going to go to us and what the schools need. It's not that. It's just going to be wasted for no reason. The textbooks are awful. I don't know how old they are. I don't even have enough textbooks in my classes to be passed around. It is sad. My education should be valued, and so does everybody. Everybody's. I think that on behalf of Graham High School, I believe that the bond needs to be met, and that the community is speaking towards a really good standpoint of why it does need to be met. There could, as of one of the student body presidents, Taylor Coffey, was talking about earlier, she's my friend, but she made clearly some points about why these needs need to be met. It's not just bogus, and it's not just, these will be fixed later on. These problems will progress in time. It's not like you can handle this and put it and set it back in the back of the room. It's eventually going to become a problem, whether or not it's in the future or right now. And this needs to be settled right now, because my education and the people, the younger students, are going to face these problems whether or not they are fixed. And I believe that these needs need to be met. Not just for my 1 year left at Graham High School, but a safer environment for the students at Graham and every other school in Alamance County. Thank you for your time, and I appreciate this time to speak.
Thank you, Ms. Mason. You may start.
Hi, my name is Kristen Powers, K-R-I-S-T-E-N, last name Powers, P-O-W-E-R-S. I'm out in Saxapaw Hall, North Carolina. And I'm here today, so I come from a Huntington's disease family, and the reason I bring that up is because growing up in that family, advocates and people trying to bring about change always came to us, the directly impacted people, when thinking about legislation and advocacy. And that the reason they did that is because they knew the people most directly impacted by these issues are the best people to make change. And so I'm here tonight as neither a student nor a parent, but someone who has talked to many community members to just echo and stress that there are many educators, many teachers, many administrators and students who have spoken here tonight who are directly impacted by these issues. And they are the ones that are the ones I think you should take into consideration the greatest, because they have to go through this every day. That's all I had to say, and thank you for your time tonight.
Thank you, Ms. Powers. Next slide.
Hi, my name is Kathy, C-A-T-H-Y, Von Hassel Davies, V-O-N-H-A-S-S-E-L hyphen D-A-V-I-E-S. And today I stand before you not as a candidate running for office, but as a realtor. One of the programs that we have in my office helps people who have slight dings in their credit buy homes. There's a company that will actually come in and purchase the home for the people and let them rent it up to 7 years while they're getting their credit history back to normal so they can get the loan. This company is in Guilford County, and it's in Orange County. It is not in Alamance County. One of the criterias that they use to pick where they go is how the schools rate. And unfortunately, Alamance schools do not rate. enough for them to come into this county, which makes me wonder what other type of incentives like this are we losing out on by companies or institutes not thinking that our schools are great enough for them. So I am definitely in support of this and give the people a chance to vote. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Victoriano Gaspar Garcia, VICTORIANO GASPAR GARCIA. And I'm a Alamance Community College student. I'm here to talk to you about the importance to have the programs at ACC, because this place is a foundation of our future. And we need support ACC to continue offering all the materials that we need for all the community, for a better future. ACC has changed my life for good. I started going to take some ACC classes for English so I can learn the second language. And I learned English. I'm still going to school right now. I'm working to get my GED diploma. And thank you all for the opportunity. And thanks all Board of Community Commissioners for your time. God bless you all.
Great. Thank you, sir. Mr. Lawler.
Hi. My name is Kurt Lawler, K-U-R-T-L-A-W-L-E-R. And I'm speaking for splitting the ABSS bond. One half should be in the maintenance, which looks like it's necessary, whether it's from poor funding from previous commissioner or poor maintenance on the schools department, that needs to be done. But I think with the high school, we need to think outside the box. We've got this huge asset that we're not using for 3 months of the summer. If we went to a school year that had three separate semesters, each one would offer the first and second semester of the training that would allow us to have the students completing two of the semesters to complete their year's work. But with three semesters, they could time it any one of the three times, the three quarters, the three semesters of the year. That would allow us to have 50% more students in the same schools. Would have to have adequate air conditioning for the summer, of course. While there's 400 people here, there's over 110,000 people who didn't show up. So the 400 people here are the ones who have the vested interest in this full funding, and I would suggest you consider the others who didn't show up. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lawler. You can start.
Good evening. My name is John Mayle, J-O-H-N-M-A-Y-L-E. I live at 3124 Blue Moon Trail, Burlington, NC, 27217. I am a junior at Eastern Alamance High School, and I am here as most of the others here in support of the bond. Classrooms at Eastern Alamance are often overcrowded. Chemistry 1, a graduation requirement, often has over 30 students in a classroom with only 35 seats, and the teacher cannot focus on each student's individual needs. And to accommodate these students, our teacher bought 8 stools using her own money, and often still there were students standing in my class. My U.S. history class has 36 people, and the other U.S. history class off a third period has 38, leaving some students without desks. Resources are also lacking at my high school. Microscopes, a basic piece of scientific equipment necessary to biology, are in disrepair, and there are only 2 that do not use a mirror to focus the light. Textbooks are in shambles, and students often find that information needed to pass a test or a state exam is missing from books. Now, aside from being a student, my mother is also a teacher at Pleasant Grove Elementary. As some here know, Pleasant Grove's K-2 wing was built in 1928, and its 3-5 wing was built in the 50s. My mother's classroom is in this older wing. Due to the roof's old age, she has come back after summer and found her room covered in black mold. There is asbestos in both the ceiling and floors. The hallway connecting the wings floods when it rains and becomes filled with worms. There is also a safety concern with classrooms in the wing. In the event of a fire, if the door is not able to be accessed, the windows would be the only point of egress. However, these windows cannot be fully opened due to their old age and are 20 feet above the ground. The proposed bond includes renovations to fix these issues not only in Pleasant Grove, but in all schools throughout the county. For those that are against the bond, I challenge them to tour the schools of ABSS and decide if the conditions of these schools is something that you would send your children to or would be an acceptable place for you to work in. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
My name is Carlos Mosqueda, CarlosMosqueda. I'm a proud student of Alamance Community College, and I'm here to put a different perspective on tonight's request. I was part of the second wave of Marines into Fallujah, Iraq in 2004. And part of the logistics team, I was a gunner in a turret on top of a Humvee, and we were pretty safe for the most part at first. We had two high-tech Humvees that would disable or at least prevent IEDs from going off because they would stop every or any signal coming in to phones, beepers, etc. Well, one day, boom, they started using pressure plates. So the truck would roll over it and go off. So what we did is we added a rolling cage in front of a big 7-ton, and then that would take the blast, and we could at least save some more troops. Then they added a trigger point or a string that was right above the rolling cage so that when the truck hit it, boom. So then we added an antenna. So we kept playing this back and forth cat and mouse game with these folks, our opponents, because that was just it. We had to up our game, they had to up our game. We upped our game, they upped their game. And tonight is just one of those things that, though this is not life and death, maybe, you know, the workforce, it's not changing. It already did. We're playing catch up. So today we're asking to allow our strategy. It's already implemented. It just is waiting to be executed. And all we need is the funds. That's why we're here. Thank you so much for allowing me to speak today. I know we all want to go home now, but there's more to discuss. Let's up our game. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mosqueda.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your service. Mr. Gatewood.
Good evening, Madam Chair.
Excuse me.
Members of the Board of Commission. My name is Algie Gatewood. That's spelled A-L-G-I-E, not A-E-I-E. Gatewood, G-A-T-E-W-O-O-D. Carlos Mosqueda, the student, ACC student who just spoke, I think articulated it even better than I can. We need to save some more troops is what he said. We need to save some more people in this county. We have a lot of wonderful people in this county. At least that has been my experience. We have built over the last several years the strongest continuum of education, I believe, in our history. That continuum looks at each student in a way wherein we know that they will make their way to college. It can be community college, that's my preference, or it could be a university, that works too. Dr. Harrison and I have implemented early college. We have expanded on the middle college, and all of this is about opportunity. It's about saving some more troops, the troops, of course, being our young people here in this county. I am reminded of something that a past governor of this state said, and it went something like this. We cannot teach 21st century job skills in 20th century facilities. And that's exactly where we are today. We must keep our eyes on the target so that we can save some more troops. I want to just make one additional comment. And that is you read about economic development, if you read about how to grow communities, how to make communities stronger financially, you will find consistently comments about investing in people, investing in skills development training, and believe it or not, investing in facilities. And this is the opportunity that we have before us today. To invest in our facilities, to invest in our people, is an investment of our in our future. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. Yes, sir.
Doug Carroll, D-O-U-G-C-A-R-R-O-L-L. Resident of Graham. I've lived in Alamance County all my life. I've got a little different perspective. Some of you here are going to be probably going to throw tomatoes at me. Some of you are going to understand. Some of you are not going to understand. My mother came here in 1955 to teach from Granville County when she got married. And she taught, she opened South Mebane when it was built, and she was the last one to retire at South Mebane. Her first check, she probably won't appreciate me saying this tonight, and she'll find out that I am speaking tonight, but that's okay. She brought home $136. She still got her first check. She brought home $136 the first month she taught. Okay? It's not against the five of y'all, and it's not against this school board. Where it goes back to the previous county commissioners and the previous school boards. We've got to get over this Democratic-Republican thing and get down to brass tacks and do what's right, whether it's the school kids or whoever it is. I mean, you know, you can play this game all you want to. I was going to run for school board this year. My mother will be 87 on Friday. Her first class is not, it's her first fifth grade class is 75 years old. They come up to her in the grocery store and say, "Ms. Carroll, thank you so much for being my fifth grade teacher and telling me what I need to do so when I go to the sixth grade, I will be prepared to even have a chance." Okay? You know, it doesn't matter. I hear this all the time. Well, we have to take low bid. You know, it's sometimes you take low bid and a company does something and they give you a 10-year warranty. 2 years later, you can't find them in the United States. Okay? So sometimes low bid ain't always the best thing to go with. Okay? I worked for this school system in 1980. I planned to retire from this school system. I had already figured out how many years I'd have to work if I took all my vacation and all my sick leave and personal time, that I could leave with 27 years and so many, well, I made it 13 months. And I was forced to resign from the school system because I was too safety-minded when I worked at the bus garage, okay? If you can understand that, I was told you are too safety minded. Okay? I won't go through what I went through. I'll talk to y'all about it if you want to. But I'm not against y'all. I'm not against the school board. We are in a crisis now of having to spend a lot of money to repair schools. I'm a 77 graduate of Eastern. I went to TIA. I saw it go to TCA. I saw it go to ACC. You know what? Education is the best thing that you can ever have. If you don't get an education, you're not going to be anything. Things have changed so drastically in the last 20 years, you know, from electronics to everything else. But it's all about everybody working together to make it so everybody has a chance to do something. But when I got ready to vote the first time, I said, "Mom, how are y'all? What part of y'all feel?" She said, "Democrat." I said, "Okay, then I reckon I'll be a Democrat too." You know what? I'm not proud to be a Democrat. I wouldn't be proud to be a Republican. I'm just proud to be a citizen of the United States, okay? And we need to work together to do what's right for everybody. I'm tired of this bickering and stuff. You know, it's education is a big part. You know, I don't know if we need, and I got to watch what I say because I know people are going to bash me for this. I don't know if we need to add on to the existing high schools and get them out of whack with enrollment and get these schools into 4A and then have problems with sports and that type of thing. I've been an advocate for a new high school. But my key is you need to build a middle school along with the high school to keep those together. Okay? So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Carroll. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak tonight? Let me ask, is there anybody on my left, your right, who would like to speak? Ms. Polly, are you coming up to speak? And what about you all? Just checking. I'm bolting up here. And what about over here? On my right, your left, is there anybody over there that would like to speak tonight? Okay, then I think that, do we have a motion to close the public
hearing? I move.
Second.
And all in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? So the public hearing is closed. Gentlemen, I would like to ask you, we've been here for 2 hours and 20 minutes. Would you folks like to take a little break? I think we would like to take a break. Let's take a 5-minute recess, please.
If we could all be seated and come to order, please. We could come to order, please. Gentlemen, we have the next thing on our agenda is under the bond proceedings, some procedural things to go through to be sure that we all see and or understand what it is that we're doing and what we're voting on as we work through this process. And the county manager will help me and correct me if, and also the finance officer will help guide us through this. We have three things under for action under the agenda item 8, bond proceedings. The first is to pass the bond order on the second reading for ABSS, and it's included in the agenda packet that was made available to the public. We have the bond order sets forth certain items, and it includes the maximum not to exceed $150 million for the purpose of certain things related to ABSS. So we will have a vote on that. And then there's a second bond order that was also made available in the packet for the public, which is identical, I think, to the ABSS bond order, except for in the identification of the recipient of the bond or the thing the bond is used for and the amount. So we have that. And then, so we'll vote on that. And then we also have a resolution calling for a special bond referendum. And I'm not going to read that when it comes to the appropriate time. I'm not to discuss it. I'm not going to read the bond referendum. But I do want to make the clarification, because I discussed it with county staff, that we have one vote for the referendum, but there will be two measures that go on the ballot. Because we do one single referendum with both ACC and ABSS on it, that does not mean that that combines the measures on the ballot. There will be two separate measures on the ballot. So if, as we go forward and discuss, if there's any need for clarification about that, I'm sure that you will ask. So. The next item on our agenda is action item 8-1, the bond order on the second reading for ABSS. So what we'll be seeking is possibly, if anyone cares to make it, a motion that pursuant to the Local Government Bond Act as amended, the County of Alamance, North Carolina is hereby authorized to contract a debt in evidence thereof to issue school bonds in an aggregate principal amount not exceeding $150 million for the purpose of providing funds with any other available funds for erecting additional school buildings and other school plant facilities, enlarging, reconstructing, renovating, and replacing existing school buildings and other school plant facilities, and acquiring any necessary land, furnishings, equipment, and appurtenant facilities, therefore, in order to provide additional school facilities in said county Second, that taxes shall be levied in an amount sufficient to pay the principal of and the interest on said bonds. Third, that a sworn statement of debt of said county has been filed with the clerk to the Board of Commissioners in for said county and is open to public inspection. And finally, fourth, that this order shall take effect when approved by the voters of said county at a referendum as provided in the Local Government Bond Act.
So move.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second. I'm sure there's
discussion. Point of order. I apologize. Put that in lay terms that I can understand a little better. What are we doing? I want to hear from the chairman.
What we are doing is issuing or authorizing a referendum to issue bonds not to exceed $150 million to provide school facilities and the other things listed in there.
But we're not setting the amount, is that correct?
Yes, the motion that is made is to set the amount at $150 million.
So that's in there?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, that is.
Now, may I ask, we sat here for 2.5 hours. Do we not get to respond to some of the things that have been put forth, some of the explanations? That?
Yes, sir. This is the time to do that, I believe.
Okay. Well, I thought we were getting ready to vote.
Oh, no. We have a motion and a second, but we take all the time you need to, any right. of the commissioners need to discuss.
Appreciate that. And I don't mean it to be negative at all. You know, just some information. I've got stuff here I want to ask you. I didn't have at any of the other meetings that I'd like to get somebody to explain to me. As far as the ACC student that was in the military, what I heard from him was they improvised. They adapted to their situation, and they improvised, and they created equipment that would be safer and get the job done. That's why the shuttle has boosters that separate and fall to the ocean, and you tow them back in and refurbish them and use them again. I'm sure they would have liked to have had brand new boosters every time that happened, but that wasn't the way it was to be. I'm not sure we improvise enough in everything that we do. Not necessarily, you know, all government, all business. But I want to ask a question. Forgive me for using this, but I can't see. The lighting in here is not real good for me anyway. I pulled this up just the other day, and it was a 5-year public school facility needs self-reporting study back to DPI. In other words, it came from ABSS, according to the definition that I read online. If I'm wrong, I apologize. That's why I'm asking. But this was done 2 years ago, and it was for the 2015-16 public schools facility needs assessment. The categories were new schools that were needed. We reported zero. Additions that we were claiming we needed, and this was just 2 years ago, and it was intended to cover 5 years. If I'm wrong, again, I apologize, but somebody's going to have to answer this one for me. Additions that were required that we were claiming was $39.8 million, renovations $53 million, furniture and equipment right at $5 million, for a grand total of $96.9 million. That was just 2 years ago. Can somebody address the difference between what I'm seeing here? Is that accurate, number one? Is it authentic? It appears to be to me. And now going to 150 over, we haven't even gotten through the 5-year plan. You understand my question, please?
Yeah, Dr. Harrison, if you would please come to the microphone.
That report was completed in the 2014-2015 school year using formula that DPI provided. That was also completed at the time that the facilities task force was organized and was working. So that report was submitted to DPI prior to our facilities task force determining there was a need for the additional high school. We have grown since that 14-15 year in the southern and the eastern zone. We have grown dramatically at South Mebane Elementary School. And actually, if you look at those needs determined and add $67 million for an additional high school, that takes us above the $150 million figure.
I hear that, and I respect that. Thank you. But again, that was 2 years ago, and we didn't think we needed the new high school then, or we'd put it down, I would assume. We knew the numbers.
You know, that was reported during my first year here. As I said, we put together the facilities task force. We were looking at the beginning of the reassignment plan, and we realized at that point, after we probably submitted that we were not going to be able to address the overcrowding here at Southern and primarily at Eastern with a minor redistricting plan. We were 600 students over capacity here, 300 at Eastern, about 60 below capacity at Graham was the only school that's below capacity. Cummings has been at capacity, 100 or so over. Williams is now over, and Western is over. Again, that was when we were in transition. We were simply completing a report. The DPI has all school systems report periodically for them to put together something for the General Assembly that demonstrates what the facility needs are across the state of North Carolina. And I think that report, Mr. Sutton, is from where the discussion about the $1.9 billion state bond had come.
Question, Dr. Harrison. If this bond is approved in November, how soon would that high school be built?
We would probably bid for engineering, architects in December, early January. Probably that's 18, 19, probably 21.
So we're still 3 years away from that happening.
Todd, is that right?
Appreciate it. I would just say that if that was 5 years ago, 7 years ago, I might agree with that philosophy, but just 2 years ago, that sounds like a big change. We have had a lot of growth in our school system. I don't think most people realize. When I first got on our board, before we merged our systems, we had, counting private schools, roughly 18,000 students. If I'm not mistaken. Now we've got county charter, private, home, online, roughly 29,000, if I'm not mistaken. So that's 11,000 increase, if I'm not mistaken, again. So it's obvious we're growing. And it's apparent to me that half of those 11 increase went basically private, charter, online, home, and the difference would be about a net of about 5,000 within the buildings that we have to put a seat under the person, the student. When I first went out to Yoder, they were putting a mobile classroom on the front yard the very day when I went out there. And I asked why. A parent aide told me, because the principal was not there that day, she was out with a sick family member, that it was due to all the counties coming in from, I mean, all the students coming in from Orange County. We had the biggest imbalance practically in the state of students coming in versus ours that were going out. And the story was that I heard was that we were actually going over the county line with school buses recruiting students to come to our system. $60 per student. I felt like, and so did some others, that the motivation was the federal, state, and local money that would flow with them. We shut the door on that, and I'm proud of it. That saved this county millions of dollars, millions, in per pupil expense, capital needs. It saved us millions. Can you imagine what schools would be needed if that had continued? And it was going to get worse. And can you imagine what the cost would be and what the demand on our system would be, and us, if it hadn't have been for all the students that went into the charter arena in private. Can you imagine? We got 6,000 now, is my understanding. I remember when it was 1,000, under 1,000. Because I was at a forum at the Paramount, and I looked out at the audience, and I said, thank goodness for choice, and I support that. But I said, every one of you out there, and it's basically the same type of crowd, I said, you ought to be concerned why the parents of 1,000 children don't want their kids to go to our schools. Can you imagine what the demand on our system would have been had it not been for those charter schools and private and online and so forth? Mobile classrooms, I despise them. That's why I said what I said about Yoder, and that's why we investigated out-of-county students, and we shut the door on it, and I'm proud of it. But our mobile classroom tally, the state average at the time was about 10% of our students, statewide, 10% of the statewide students were in mobile classrooms. Ours was 5%, half the state average. I was proud of that. I've bounced around on this a lot. It's been the hardest decision I've had to really come up with in the last 20 years. My kids went to public schools. They went to Cummings. All three, my two boys and my stepdaughter. I was on the facilities task force. I came out here, went to Eastern. Our kids do deserve better than to be herded like cattle down a sidewalk into a classroom and or a cafeteria. They deserve better. I had better in a dirt poor high school in South Carolina. I had better. I disagree. I'm not going to get into the topics because I'm not on the school board. But I can assure you there are certain things that I've seen voted on that's, to me, Dr. Harrison and I have even talked about one of them, and I'm not going to bring it up other than to say I disagree with one of the angles of what is going on. To me, one of the things I wholeheartedly disagree with, to me, is a social experiment on what to do with children of certain socioeconomic conditions. I guess that's enough said. But I'm not going to let my decision on this be influenced by how I feel about that angle. I think if you manage Cummings properly, and if you manage Graham properly, and push to get those schools to be what you say you want them to be, especially if they're going to stay there year-round, that can be a total success. I believe that. I'm sure some people might not agree with me on this, on our board and as well as out in the public, but I believe it. But if it's managed properly, and the key thing that convinced me was when Dr. Harrison told me the kids will stay there all day and get their core education there. Sending them there half a day, going back, I don't think it would work, but I think it can work the way I hear it's being planned. Now, I started looking at the maps. I had a survey that I was looking at out of Raleigh that I think even the school system even solicited from the agency out of Raleigh that was commissioned by the state legislature that showed that they honestly didn't believe our school system was going to be larger 5 years from now than it is today. And I thought, really? I mean, they were off by 4,000 when they did the first study. They said today we would have 4,000 more students in our system than we've got. They were wrong. Now they're reducing it down to where it's technically less than what we have today, they say. Do I buy that? No. It's a surprise, probably, to a lot of people. But I've looked at it every which way I can. I'm not trying to turn it down, not trying to vote no. I'm trying to be happy with my vote. I think, personally, that charter private and online, I think is peaking. That's my personal opinion. You hear the talk out there of charter schools coming up everywhere. They are in Greensboro, I'll assure you. And there's rumors of them wanting to pop up here even more. But I've looked at the maps, and I honestly think if you're putting that school between Eastern and Southern, it can work. Yes, we haven't built a new high school in this community in 50 years. And how we got by with that was a miracle. Being in the center of the state on two of the busiest interstates on the East Coast, we hadn't had to build a high school in 50 years. That's stunning. I believe in brick and mortar, and I believe in a properly run public education system. There's no way everybody can go charter. There's no way everybody can go private. So are these kids that come to Eastern, come here, are they less than those students, morally, ethically? No, not at all. They deserve not to be herded in the groups that I see. Now, in the bond referendum, you're proposing to enlarge this school. At first, you said you couldn't, because I brought it up. You're proposing to enlarge Eastern. When I questioned that, we can't do it. Now I hear that it's on the table to enlarge it. Both of those. This is probably my last go-around, but I'm not going to walk out of this county thinking that I shirk my responsibility for brick-and-mortar schools in this county. I'm not going to do it. Could we get by with a lower amount? If you lowered it to 100, and I'm not saying I'm going to make that motion. I'm just saying if you lowered it to 100, you'd get a new high school. That would leave you 30-some million to do some repairs and additions, but that's not a lot of money. That's not a lot of money. Could you combine that with the thought of what the state might give us if the state bond referendum passes? What's that, $24 million more? $2 million from us a year, lottery money? You know, could you combine all that? It'd be a gamble. I had bounced around like a ping pong ball. But I support a new high school. I honestly do. I don't support some of the redistricting theories, but I wasn't asked to make that vote. But I've said that I was willing to go with a lower amount, but I want the people to vote. It's their county, it's not ours.
That's right.
Would business do it differently? I think so. I don't think there's any question that business might do it differently. But some of the things I see and hear is, I don't think fair in regards to what we've done in the past with monies for the schools. I think we've, at least with my votes, I've always supported basically doing, except for maybe their operating budget. I don't think I've ever been a very negative person on capital. And I think this is a capital question. And as much as I wish we could consider a lower figure, Bill's going to get mad at me because I think I told Bill I'd probably go with a lower amount, 100. I told Alamance News that. But I've looked at a lot of stuff since then. I'm willing to let the people vote on this. But you do have to think about, are the citizens going to vote for three things? ACC, ABSS, and the sales tax. Are they going to vote for all three? Would there be a better chance of getting those three if they felt like we had compromised? I don't see any effort here to have compromised. My compromise was pretty much doing what I said. First, I didn't think a new high school was needed. I was very skeptical on it. Never said no. Now I'm saying yes. I think a compromise would serve us all better. I honestly do. But I don't see an effort here for the compromise. So with that said, I'm willing to go ahead and put it on the ballot and let the people decide. And I know I ramble. But there's nothing like a high school or a school that's there 50 years from now that's still in good shape. Look at Williams High School. Look at Ashboro High School, built like a castle. That school will be gone when I'm got daisies growing on top of Alamance Memorial Park space. But I don't have anything else to say other than I just had to get my heart out there as to what I'm thinking, what I've been thinking, and what I believe.
Boss, what do you have any?
Yeah, 3 years ago when I got on the board, back on the board, Pam Thompson said, let's take a bus ride. And we've been on an educational tour for the last several years. And by doing that, I got in the schools, got to see what was behind the scene. And I know the work needs to be done in our schools, renovation, as well as I do know that we need a new high school. I got a granddaughter here that doesn't go to lunch here because she said it's too much trouble to even get into the cafeteria because of the student population. I got grandkids at Elon. I'm looking forward to them going into the new elementary school that Elon's providing us. Thank you, Mr. Doolin. I'm 100% in support of this. And that's all I got to say.
Thank you. Mr. Byrd?
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank everybody who spoke tonight. You were very, very good, and I really couldn't add anything. To me, this is not a hard decision. This is a slam dunk decision. And the decision to pass the motion that I presented. I have been watching this process since I've been elected. So that's 3.5 years. I've seen a lot of work go into figuring out what was really needed. I went to some of the public hearings that the school board had on the redistricting. I saw a lot of iterations come out of that process about how things should be redistricted, and a lot of iterations about what the needs were in our facilities. Although I wasn't technically a member of the Joint Facilities Task Force, I think I attended every meeting. Been in a lot of schools. I've seen for myself the desperate needs that our schools have. I know how important our school system is and the importance of education, not only because of the impact that it has on our kids, but the impact that it has on our community, the ability to recruit businesses and professionals to this community. The $150 million for ABSS, in my opinion, based on everything that I've seen and the questions that I've asked and the answers that I've gotten, is a bare bones amount. And it, in some ways, I wish that could be more like 200 or 220 million. But this is what it is, 150 million. I don't know how we could possibly reduce that. What would we omit? I think Dr. Boylston was pretty, the way she presented that was pretty effective. And we can kick the can down the road some more if we want, but really, this, we can't afford to keep doing that either. I look at the constitutional and statutory obligation and duty that we have as a Board of Commissioners to provide for facilities for our schools. So for all these reasons, it's pretty much a slam dunk decision for me. I'd like to respond to a couple of comments that I heard tonight. Mr. Vines, you think that it's going to be 13 cents on the tax rate, yet we have the consultant from Davenport here tonight, Brian Haygood, our county manager, did a tremendous job at presenting options that was just an early ballpark, back of the napkin kind of figure. That's not reality. And we already passed the maximum amount that this would be 7.88 cents. But we have options to have that tax rate way lower. I mean, we have an option to get it down to less than 2 cents if we do that quarter cent sales tax and do a couple of other adjustments as to how we structure the bond issues. So there's no sugarcoating, as you suggested, Mr. Vines. To the gentleman that spoke about the people that were in the room having a vested interest, I sort of take offense to that. The people that are here are not interested in their own well-being. They're interested in our kids and our community. So there's no vested interest of the people who spoke tonight. Tim, just to talk about charter schools for a moment. To me, I've always felt like, and this was part of our vision, that our school system should be so good that it would attract the best teachers and retain them, and it would attract, people would choose our school system, our public education system, because it would be the best for their children. And in some ways, I feel like with this movement about privatizing public education, we're setting up a self-fulfilling prophecy, because we squeeze the money to our public education system to the extent we're forcing people to choose something different, because they feel like that's best for their kids.
Please, no applause. Please do not do that. It's not appropriate this time. Thank you.
So all in all, this I think that the process that our school board and the school leadership has gone through to get us to this point was a great process. There's a lot of smart people involved. I really have a great deal of respect for the leaders that we have in our school system. We are not the school board. We're a board of commissioners. We have a little bit different role, and we have to have some faith in the leaders that our community has elected to lead our school system to come to the decision that they did and ask the request for the bond request that they've asked. So that's my comments.
Thank you. Mr. Lashley?
Yes. I want to say that I support the school system of 100%, but this school system administration is a disgrace. I've sat on this board for 20 years, and the maintenance has been piss poor, and it's not getting any better with the most overpaid administrator in the whole state. This is a disgrace, and the voters aren't going to vote for this wasted money. We give y'all the money, and you don't take care of the little things, and you wanted the voters to vote for more money. You're whistling up the world. They're not going to do it, and I'm going to vote against it. I think it's a disgrace what the school board allows y'all to get by with.
All right, so I, like Commissioner Sutton, have spent many hours thinking about this decision and weighing the different ways of looking at it. One thing I would like, thinking about the speaker, the first thing I wanted to say, this is very important, I wanted to recognize the awesome job that our county staff has done in preparing this bond to this point. They have been so professional and so just on target with the goal of doing their job, not advocating for a position, not advocating against a position, but just making sure that we had done everything that we were supposed to do to get to this point. And I really, I'm grateful for our county staff, I really am. So I think that letting the people decide is not a partisan statement, and letting the people decide is not an anti-taxpayer sentiment. I think that we should let the people decide what kind of community they want to live in and how do they want it to look. Going through our speakers, Ed Hooks really spoke to me when he was talking about the growth in Mebane. And I originally ran for county commissioner in 2016, the heart of my platform, my campaign, has always been preparing for growth and thinking about all the people who are moving here and how are we going to integrate that into our community without losing our sense of ourselves and without just becoming a cookie cutter interstate town. So the things that Mr. Hook spoke about, I thought were extremely relevant. The idea that we've got decades of neglect, like one speaker said, I would challenge that. There's a there's an article in today's New York Times which talks about school systems, counties, towns across this nation are facing the same problems that Alamance County is facing in 2018 because it's been 10 years since the recession hit, and there are a lot of things that had to be put aside for another day. And I think that that is why our schools' maintenance has been not what we would have hoped it to be, not because of, you know, neglect on the part of any kind of elected official. I think that's just the way it is. And you can see that across the country, that schools have neglected maintenance, and then they also are overcrowded and need to build. So I think it's unfruitful to talk about the past. I think it is fruitful to talk about what's needed now, what kind of challenges do we have, and how do we deal with them. I think that we have commissioners and a county manager who will follow up with the school system to see that the people's will is carried out, that there will be oversight, there will be some supervision, there will be some accountability for how this money is spent if the electorate decides to vote for the referendum in November. So I think we should let the people decide. And I think that the school board should have the opportunity, the education advocates should have the opportunity to make their case to the people. So with that being said, is there any further discussion?
Got a motion, a second. Let's vote on it.
Okay, so all in favor of Commissioner Byrd's motion of putting the referendum to the voters of Alamance County as provided in the Local Government Bond Act at the amount of $150 million, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, please say no.
No.
So that carries on a 4-1 vote. All right, next on our agenda is the bond order on the second reading for Alamance Community College. So we'll take a look at that language that was furnished to the public in our agenda packet. So it's a similar language that pursuant to the general statutes and the Local Government Bond Act that the County of Alamance would be authorized to contract a debt in a principal aggregate principal amount not exceeding $39,600,000 for the purpose of providing funds for expanding and improving the facilities for Alamance Community College, and then including the construction of additional buildings and other facilities, the enlargement, reconstruction, renovation, and repair of existing buildings, and so forth. Second, the taxes shall be levied in an amount sufficient to pay the principal of and said interest on said bonds. Third, that a sworn statement of the debt of said county has been filed with a clerk to the Board of Commissioners for said county and is open to public inspection. And fourth, that this order shall take effect when approved by the voters of said county at a referendum as provided in said act.
So moved.
Second.
So we have motion and a second to approve that at the not to exceed $39,600,000. What kind of discussion is there?
I just want to thank Carlos for his service that came up here today. I think we're blessed to have people like him in our community college, and just wanted to thank him for giving us this right to be here tonight.
Anything else?
Tremendous asset. We need to keep it going.
Well, gentlemen, if there's no further discussion,
moved.
Let's. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? So the ACC bond goes forward. Now, finally, under 8, Section 3, we have the resolution calling for a special bond referendum to be held between 6:30 a.m. and 7:30 p.m. on Tuesday, November 6, 2018, that the Board of Elections would be requested to conduct the referendum and to take all necessary steps to that end. We'll publish a notice and follow the law with that. And then the form of the questions to appear on the ballots and in the instructions to voters for said referendum shall be as follows, and then it is listed in the information, the agenda packet, which I will not read. There's one vote to approve the referendum, and these two separate measures will go on the ballot. Are there any questions about that, or any questions about what we're voting on with the referendum?
Sales tax isn't in there, right?
That's correct. Sales tax is the next item for business.
Both bonds, basically, on the ballot. I make a motion that we approve that resolution.
Second.
Okay, let me just check with county staff, Mr. Manager and Finance Officer, have I done what I'm supposed to do? And so, okay, good. All right, so is there any further discussion about that? Hearing none, all in favor of this resolution, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, so that is it for the bond proceedings. Next on our agenda is a resolution for a 1/4 cent sales tax. It's in the packet before, and I don't intend to read it. Mr. Hagan, oh, you're there. Okay, will you tell us about it?
Yes, good evening, Chair Gailey and Commissioners. What you have before you, your next item, is a resolution calling for a November 6, 2018 special advisory referendum concerning the levy of a 1/4 cent county sales and use tax. If you vote to approve this resolution, the item will be on the ballot in November. If the voters approve the item in November, it will give you the authority to levy the 1/4 cent sales tax, which will generate approximately $4.8 million annually. And you have a copy of the language that will be put on the ballot in your packet that will actually appear. So we're asking that you consider this resolution. It does take action.
On a positive note on that, I hope, can we get Mac Williams, would you be willing to stipulate or say, or anybody else here can say, that 60% of the sales tax, whether it be this or the other or whatever comes in from out of the county, can we say that? Be nice to know. Yeah. Can anybody say, Brian, have you ever had anybody be, don't they trace this stuff?
Now, didn't you do a study the last time, though? Didn't Chamber do something on that? The last go round, yeah. I was thinking you had some numbers. Right.
Oh, I would say so.
Yeah.
And we do not track the sales tax receipts that way, so I wouldn't be able to comment on it either.
Can you also tie together, if that passes, a range of what the tax rates would be property-wise?
Yes, you know, as you recall, we looked at several scenarios if both bonds pass. Currently, we've said we've estimated the highest tax rate to be 7.88 cents. We'll discuss a resolution in a moment where the commissioners will consider putting the proceeds toward this this education capital needs. You would be able to take 3.62 cents off the sales tax of whatever. So, you know, 7.88 is the most that we've estimated currently. If we do some structuring, it could even come down further, but it's safe to say approximately 3.62 cents would be saved on property tax if this passes by the voters.
So the property tax theoretically could be an increase of 3 cents.
It would be 3.62 less. So instead of 7.88 cents, if the measure passes on the ballot and the voters vote to institute this sales tax, you'd be able to take 3.62 cents off the 7.88 cents. Right. And it could be even lower than that. You know, as the board recalls, we talked about the possibility of doing some level of structuring debt and bringing the property tax impact down lower. 7.88 cents is our highest.
So 7.9 minus 3.6 is, we have a math teacher that can do that math for us.
we have that data.
I'm trying to get it to the correct page so I can give you the exact amount.
Well,
32 or 33.
Roughly is good. I mean, that's a significant decrease.
Yeah.
So can I comment on this? I talked to Brian earlier today. So the way this is going to appear on the ballot, it'll say for or against. You check off one of those two boxes for this statement. Local sales and use tax at the rate of 0.25% in addition to all other state and local sales and use taxes. So that's not very, it's not going to be on the ballot in a very convincing sort of way.
It's exciting to vote on that, is that what you're saying?
And I understand that that's a statutorily
That's
correct.
That's what I was told.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes. That's the language required by the state.
So I mean, where the other questions about the bonds that'll be on the ballot is very explicit about what that money's going to be used for, and this doesn't even say.
They can't state it on.
And so we're going to have to. I'm in favor of doing the quarter cent because of the impact that it has on the property tax rate increase. But
I think what we estimated in the event the sales tax passed, we would go from a 7.88 cent estimated property tax increase to a 4.23 property tax increase. That would be using all the sales tax revenue toward this this capital plan.
And we'll vote on that separately. Is that
that's the next thing on our? Yes, sir.
And there is an opportunity to do the structured debt or something. The third column in the Davenport report, for lack of a better term. That I'm committed, if I'm still serving in this capacity, to go to the local government commission and seek approval for that, and that would reduce the potential tax rate even further.
That's correct. And I think we've discussed that once the we know the outcome of the vote on the bonds, then it'll be the time to go talk to the local government commission about using structured debt and how much we should use. But the bottom line, it would reduce the impact of the property tax even further.
Well, did anybody make a motion?
I'll make the motion. Bill's going to make a motion.
I'll make the motion. We support the 0.25% sales tax. And I will vote for that.
Was there a second for that?
I second.
Is there any more discussion? I would just like to say that I think a sales tax is a better way to pay for these bonds, because everybody pays, everybody buys stuff. The more you spend, the more you're going to pay, and then a lot of it will be paid by people outside of the county and capturing that revenue from visitors. So is there any more discussion?
One more item on there. What would it be applied to?
We're going to vote on that thing.
No, I'm not talking about appropriations. I'm talking about the people, what they're, the people you're charging that tax to. What would it won't be food items, right?
That's correct. Everything that the regular, the 2% sales tax is applied to now, it would be applied to.
What would it not be applied to? Can you give us any
guess? Everything but food.
It would be retail sales, excluding food, that you would purchase at a grocery store. Now, if you went to a restaurant,
right,
right. Sales tax pass. Also, it would go for certain services that the state assembly enacted the sales tax to go against as well.
So one item that was presented by one of the speakers tonight was whether or not that would, if we're going to have the same sales tax as the counties around us, is that going to reduce the incentives for people to drive from those communities to ours because they're paying less sales tax? Is that even a valid consideration? I mean, are people shopping? Maybe Matt could.
Well, I think when we worked with Davenport to come up with the approximate $4.8 million worth of revenue, we looked around Central Piedmont, and of course, not every county in Central Piedmont has this Article 46. In fact, I think there were a couple of our neighbors, I don't remember off the top of my head, that don't have that sales tax. So I don't know that it would be terribly noticeable in everyday purchases. Perhaps when you get into the large purchases, some luxury items or very costly items, you may notice it then, of course.
Guilford currently does not have.
Okay. There are several of our neighbors that do not have the sales tax. So
I think it's interesting that if you buy food at a farmer's market, unprocessed things, you pay no sales tax. That's exempt, as long as it's not processed. So we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, all in favor of the resolution as presented, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and then the next item on our agenda has to do with a resolution with the proceeds, committing to the use of proceeds. So it would be a resolution of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners confirming that if the voters of the county approve a 1/4 cent county sales and use tax, the annual revenue produced thereby shall be used for education and training programs. So this resolution is written with the intent that, suppose that the bonds do not pass, but the sales tax does, that we would apply the revenue from this 1/4 cent sales tax to education, whether it's through ABSS or ACC, whether it's through capital outlay or operating expenses. So that would be the intention of that resolution.
I move that we adopt that resolution.
Second.
Does anybody have any concerns with how it's worded or anything like that? Okay, so if we have a motion and a second, then all in favor of the resolution, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? I'm a little late up here. Okay, great. Thank you so much. Next on the agenda is our budget request presentations. Now it's 10:22. We do have an audit contract that has to be done tonight, and we have a health department request that has to be done tonight. I'd ask the county manager, since it's 10:22 and we're looking at two big and important budget presentations, would it be possible, if the board so chooses, to postpone those presentations until our next meeting?
Yes, I believe we could. The next step in our budget calendar is presentation of manager's recommended budget, which was originally scheduled for May the 7th. If we postpone the presentations by Thomas Burnham School System and the Community College this evening, then we would, it'd be ideal if we could do those on May the 7th, then we would postpone the manager's recommended to the 21st. We also have representatives here this evening from our outside agencies that they've come in the event the commissioners have any questions for them. We would ask that they would come back on the 7th in the event, again, that the commissioners have questions for them. So we could work it in the bond calendar. It would still give us time to get a budget passed, hopefully, before
year that. When would we do the public hearing for the operating budget?
If we go with the delay this evening, we do presentations by the school system at ACC on May the 7th. Manager's recommended would be presented on May the 21st, and then the first meeting in June would be the public hearing, and then the second meeting in June would hopefully be the evening that the commissioners will adopt the budget. So
everything gets moved back a meeting.
That's right. We go back one meeting in the event, second meeting in June, we couldn't come to resolution about the budget. We still have time to do a special call to get get it done before July 1.
What do you folks think
I'm
about
good
that?
With it. Otherwise, we'll be here at 2 o'clock probably in the morning.
What do you think, Mr. Sutton? Are you okay with continuing those two items from this agenda until the next meeting?
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
All right, so then if I'm seeking a motion, I'll make the motion. I'll make a motion.
Make a motion.
To continue until the next meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, action items 9, 3, and 4, the community college budget request presentation, and the Alamance Burlington School System budget request presentation, that those be continued until our next meeting.
Second.
Which is the 7th of May.
7th of May, our next
meeting. That's right.
That's a morning meeting.
And that's a morning meeting. What do you think about that?
If the board wants to change that to an evening meeting, now would be the time.
I appreciate it if you keep it on a morning. I have a class that night.
They can make it.
That's enough as it is, but
we're not going to make that decision.
Okay. Dr. Harrison and Dr. Gatewood, would that suit your schedule? Would that be okay?
Morning meeting
be okay. Yeah.
Okay. So I've made a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
So is there any more discussion? All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Apologize to you guys.
Yeah. So, Ms. Evans, the finance officer, has an audit contract that requires action tonight.
Give her about 10 minutes. I'll clear out.
My heart's there, I know that. I'm like a few people mad, but
at least I was honest about it.
Congratulations.
All right, Ms. Evans.
Good evening, commissioners. At the last meeting, we presented an audit contract from Martin Starnes in the amount of $98,000. At the request of the board, I contacted Martin Starnes to verify that the increase is due to the hours necessary to complete our audit with the new auditing standards provided by the state. The rates per hour have remained the same, but however, in talking to them with some improved efficiencies, they are now proposing a contract of $90,000, which would need the board's approval tonight for us to submit to the LGC to meet our deadline there. And we will issue an RFP for auditing services during fiscal year 18-19.
So you saved the county $8,000 for asking. That
yes,
was
sir.
A good ask. Thank you. I'll make a motion that we...
I'll second it.
So we have a motion and a second that we approve this contract. Any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, next we have a health department, but thank you. The Health Department Budget Amendment.
So what you have before you tonight is actually a request to use performance management money, which is also a budget amendment. And so what you have is the performance management spending request in the amount of $68,425.98 to be used on two projects that are capital improvements for the facility. The first one being to enclose the main entrance of the Human Service Center to make it ADA compliance. And so because we share that space with DSS, they have half of that cost, and so we are incurring the other half, and we would like to use performance management monies to do that. The second request is also for capital improvements. It's our share, the health department's share, of the new smart lock systems that we want to put into the facility to upgrade the facility, to keep our staff safe, and for the health department's piece to make sure that we're HIPAA compliant and that we're keeping confidentiality at mind. And so our share of that is 58% of the cost of the total cost of those locks, and that's the second request that you see of $48,725.98.
I guess Susan isn't going to use her performance management money to pay for her share.
I do not know. Health department needs to use their fee.
I move approval of. They have money? Okay. I move approval of the request.
Second.
Great. We have a motion and a second to approve the use of funds. Is there any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. County manager, do you have a report?
I just wanted to inform the board. As you know, we've been working on selecting a firm to do our facility plan. We had 11 responses. We interviewed four firms. We've selected Clark, Patterson, and Lee. Clark, Patterson, and Lee recently purchased Moser, Meyer, Phoenix that were in Greensboro that we've worked with before in the past, so we've been pleased with them. Bill Moser will be our direct rep with Clark, Patterson, Lee. I'm preparing to sign a contract with Clark, Patterson, Lee for up to $50,000 in services. This is within my purview as manager, so I don't need board approval here tonight, and we do have the funds budgeted to do this. I want to let you know that the first and most immediate part of this plan will be to review the condition of our current buildings and also to focus on the buildings that we have that are empty, Kernodle, Easttown, Rudd Street, South Annex, and the Peak property, to help us quickly determine what we need to do with these buildings. As you know, these are deteriorating fast, and we've got to make some decisions quickly. We'll use Clark Patterson to help us do that. And also, we are going to get them to look at two buildings that need immediate roof repair, and we're kind of on the fence about, do we even want to keep these buildings? That would be the CSI building located in Graham and Environmental Health over on Graham Hopedale Road. We'll be expecting to receive from Clark Patterson recommendations for whether they should be demolished or repaired and how we should dispose of the properties, or if we should dispose of these properties. We've talked about this before, especially when we were going through the Kernodle sale issue. We also have some pressing special projects that we'll be asking Clark Patterson to help us with. We're starting to need space for our voting machine storage. We currently store those at a building that we lease from Ralph Scott. That's becoming problematic. We also are about to experience significant growth in the state's juvenile justice program. You know, they lowered the, or they adjusted the age for juvenile defense, and they're bringing on more staff in a year. We need help figuring out what to do with those new folks. And we also are looking, going to have Clark Patterson help us survey county departments in order to show what their current space uses are and where they see themselves growing. All these phase ones will be delivered. This phase one deliverables will be done by Labor Day. Our next phase would be to interview the courts and get their growth needs, and also, and then to match all of our needs with the current facilities that we have and see where we stand. But there's no action needed on this. I just wanted to let you know that we have selected Clark Patterson and Lee, and we're excited about getting on with our facility plan. So you'll be hearing more from me about it in the future. But if there's any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
I'm just so glad that you're going down this path. It's badly needed.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Is there any commissioner comments tonight?
It's too late.
Hearing none, we'll be adjourned.